welcome to Football Park in Adelaide for the 1997 SANFL Grand Final between Port Adelaide and Norwood. It's been a week of high drama as Norwood skipper Gary McIntosh, reported in the preliminary final, was suspended for one match, and a lot of speculation here in Adelaide as to whether it will be in fact his last game. His coach hopes he'll go on next year and perhaps get them into a grand final again. The other bad news for Port Adelaide, Scott Hodges, their champion full forward, made himself available for selection but sadly was overlooked by the match committee. Well, one man who knows a little bit about winning grand finals joins us this afternoon, Ken Sheldon, three-time premiership player with Carlton and former St Kilda coach.
Thank you, David. Well, you know, I think the McIntosh situation is if you're found guilty, obviously you have to be suspended. And with the Hodges situation, if you're not fit, well, there isn't any room for you in grand finals.
Now, for interstate viewers, the SANFL have changed their rule on video reporting this week. I think they've been distressed by suspending such a great and true South Australian champion.
Well, there's no doubt McIntosh is regarded in some circles, and I don't disagree either, as possibly one of the best players to ever play football at any level. Certainly a great tragedy for him personally, but again, if found guilty, he must be suspended.
Weather conditions in Adelaide are fine, but late showers expected late in the afternoon, so we'll be watching for that and we'll keep an eye on the weather for you. The current temperature is 19.5, and as we've mentioned, showers developing late and southeast winds 10 to 15 knots. As we go head-to-head, these sides have met twice this year. It's a 2-2 record, but Norwood inflicted Port Adelaide's biggest loss ever in round 5 by 122 points at Adelaide Oval. Jim West kicked 5-1 that day for Norwood, who was the star.
That was a magic day, and just a magic day for Norwood, no doubt about that. Round 15, Port Adelaide responded with a 16-point turnaround. They had no McIntosh, no McCormack, and no Ian Downs by that day, who significantly are not playing here today.
Yes, and the second semi-final, Port Adelaide trailed midway through the third quarter, but in classic Port Adelaide style, they kicked 8-1 in the third quarter, or in the second half, to overcome the Redlegs and go straight to the grand final. Norwood, on the other hand, had the hard route, so they had to overcome a very determined Central District in the preliminary final, and they get a chance for their first flag this year since 1984. Well, we need to go a little while back to 1984, and one man who might remember the 84 grand final and two giants belting it out in the goal square is Mark Daly, the former South Adelaide and Carlton star.
It does surprise me, David, that it has been that long since those two sides have played in the grand final, but I can tell you right now that the atmosphere down here is electric. I remember back in that game, you're seeing the big full forward, the Port Adelaide full forward and Tim Evans up against their coach's brother in Craig Balme, toe-to-toe while the national anthem was being played, but don't be surprised if something happens this afternoon.
Well, Mark, tell us, who do you think might be the two heavyweights going at it this afternoon?
Yeah, there could be. I reckon centre-half forward, we've got a player called Pasco, who's a fair heavyweight for Norwood. He'll be up against the big bloke at Nigel Figgett, the centre-half back. Just don't be surprised if those two blokes have a go. And then at the other end, David, you've got Darren Smith for Port Adelaide playing centre-half forward up against the tough Lachlan Bowman at centre-half back. That also should be a tough clash.
Fair enough. Tim Evans and Craig Balme have gone into South Australian football folklore. But at the time, they were just a couple of heavyweights who had no respect for the national anthem.
Traditional rivals, and well, that's really the heat that's in the atmosphere here at the moment in this magnificent stadium. As quoted before, it is absolutely electrifying.
Well, it was a grand final, and we were a bit toey. I think that's all there was to it. Lots of pushing and shoving, but we get on fine now.
I recall he might have said a few minor words to me, and I think things went from there. So I must admit I didn't remember the actual national anthem. Someone said there was a nice young lady singing the national anthem, but I didn't see her, I must admit.
A couple of great old combatants having a beer this week. We caught up with them all down on the boundary line. Our boundary rider Rob Popplestone this afternoon, the former Sturt and Eagle champion.
Thanks for that, DB. Great to watch those sort of incidents in grand finals, isn't it? The coach of the 84 Premiership for Norwood that year, of course, was Neil Balme. And Neil, it's almost an injustice that Port Adelaide have played and won 7 grand finals since, and Norwood still searching.
Oh, well, I mean, every year they've been terrific. They've always been like that. Even watching the reserves game, they came back from nowhere, so they've got enormous spirit, and you've got to admire them and have respect for them.
Have you got a particular moment in that 84 grand final that sort of still tugs at the heartstrings?
Well, I still now. I get goosebumps when I think about Keith Thomas taking that mark just out there. It was really a marvellous effort. Took no account for all the people around him. A great catch.
It was a sensational year too, winning from fifth spot that year from the elimination final, the first and only time it's ever been done.
Well, it was a huge year. The big crowd, I'm sure they're not cheering us for that. it was a huge year. It was very difficult, and there was a chance in most of the finals that we could have been beaten, so it was a terrific effort from the guys to hang in.
Good on you, Balme. I hope we see another great game like that of 84 and DB. It all promises to look, it promises to be that way today in 1997.
Let's hope it is, Rob. The big cheers you heard was for the Pilgrim parachuting team, who just shooted in while Neil Balme was talking to Rob Popplestone. Mick Honeyman, Jan Honeyman, and the team, well done, added an extra dimension to our 1997 SANFL Grand Final. As we go down to the Port Adelaide rooms, and Steve Williams and his team just warming up. Ken, there's Port Adelaide just meandering through their warm-up.
Very professional in their approach. It is really another day at the office. Like, grand finals are really all about courage, persistence. They're about absolute desperation, I guess. And in the end, you've got to be effective with your chances with the football. Port Adelaide, of course, at the end of it, will only be looking for one result, and that's to be ahead on the scoreboard.
Well, Stephen Williams has already won one premiership. Last year, he did it in his first year. He took over from John Cale mid-season and won a flag. Not a bad effort. The only, the 11th man in South Australia to win a flag in his first year. We caught up with him during the week.
Steve, there's a real air of anticipation about training tonight. The boys look very confident.
Yeah, they are. We've been in this situation a lot of times over the last few years, and everyone knows where we're headed.
Is this your best side that you're playing in the grand final?
I think, yeah, if you to go through our side for the whole year, I reckon the 21 that will play this week would be the best we would have available.
You've only been the second best team during the year. Do you feel any pressure about that statistically?
Not really, no. The major round's a different story than the minor round. We won the second semi and we're going in pretty confident.
Any negatives over that drubbing you received from a Manzac day? You don't see a blowout like that grand final day?
I wouldn't imagine, no. That was just one of those days where we were pretty ordinary and they were fantastic, so I wouldn't imagine something like that could happen.
And you must feel the pressure of Port Adelaide fans, the expectation of demanding yet another premiership.
Yeah, it's probably no different than it ever has been. Obviously, they're very keen on winning another premiership, and we're the same, so it's a good formula to have.
And obviously, you're very confident you can win?
Oh, without a doubt, yeah, we were. You know, we played pretty well on second semi-final day and won, and I think we can do, you know, 20-25% better than that, so we're pretty confident, yeah.
Very confident, Coach Stephen Williams. There's the Port Adelaide side, Ken. No Scott Hodges this year for the first time for a couple. George Fiachi, who played in the reserves, has retired, as has Mark Tyler, and no Greg Anderson.
Yes, Richard Ambrose taking up the position full forward. He will combine a three-pronged attack with Darren Smith, the ever-reliable centre-half forward, and also Warren Treadray. So a bit of damage there, a possibility for the Port Adelaide side.
Borlase in the middle gets the job, you'd suspect, on Andrew Jarman, the danger man for the Redlegs.
Yes, it'll be interesting to see the Norwood strategy to release Jarman from the tag. No doubt Borlase will pick him up in the midfield. Perhaps if he goes to defence, perhaps, goodness knows who you might find on him there. But Jarman really has to produce more in this final. A lot of pressure on the McGarry medalist.
As we go down to the Norwood room, the Norwood locker room, and the players down there. We caught up with them early just warming up. They also look pretty relaxed, as the Port Adelaide players did, Ken.
Well, they're both very, very professional units. They are the best performed teams in the SNFL this year. Red Legs have ended up on top of the ladder. Peter Rohde in screen there, the coach of the Red Legs. Tremendous. I think a tremendous strategist of the game. He really does understand it.
For our interstate viewers, Peter Rohde played 46 games for Carlton, 117 games with Melbourne. A pretty good apprenticeship for coaching at this level.
Yes, it really is. John Cunningham, number 16 in screen there. Question over his fitness. Number 29 just going through is Lachlan Bowman. And number 9, the leading goal kicker, Jim West.
Well, Norwood were third last year, knocked out in the preliminary final by Port Adelaide. They were minor premiers in 1997, easily the best team of the year. And during the week, I caught up with Peter Rohde.
Pete, there seems to be an air of anticipation around the club tonight. History in the making. Can you take it off the first time since 84?
Oh, I certainly think we can take it off. Obviously, Port would be thinking the same thing as well, but you know, it's a two-horse race and we've got ourselves in a good position, and we've got to make quite sure we get the money today.
Have you got your best side in for this match?
Obviously, Paul McCormack, who did his knee in the preliminary final, is going to be a big loss for us, but you know, I don't think any team ever goes in the grand final without their best team. We're just going to make sure we've got 21 who are having a go on the day, and hopefully those 21 can take it off for us.
Well, you're the best team during the year, 17 wins, 3 losses, the best forward zone, the best defensive zone. It'll mean nothing unless you win today.
No, well, the minor round is really a competition of its own, and that enabled us to qualify on top of the ladder at the end of the home and away season. But when it comes to the grand final, there's two teams there. Start off on equal terms. When the umpire bounces the ball, it'll be 0-0, and we'll go from there.
Anzac Day, you blitzed Port Adelaide by 122 points. Do you see anything like that sort of blowout today?
No, I think that, you know, that was a long time ago, obviously, and the two teams have changed a lot since then, and obviously Port got their act together a lot towards the end of the year. You know, we were playing pretty good footy at that stage, and everything fell into place that day, but that, you don't have grand finals like that. We won't be expecting to win in that sort of fashion. Win by 1 point, we'll be very happy.
Do you feel the pressure as a coach of Norwood fans, having not won a flag since 84 and believing this is their year?
Well, to a certain degree you do. I think coming into the finals you feel a lot of pressure. Probably once you get into the routine of the finals, you know, you just focus on the games that are coming up and you tend to ignore a lot of that other stuff. But certainly you get a lot of letters from supporters and a lot of comments around the club and stuff, and there is a bit of pressure there. But, you know, coming to a grand final, there's plenty of pressure anyway, so it just ward off a duck's back.
Good luck.
Thank you.
There's the Norwood side, and you'd have to ask the question, Ken, no Gary McIntosh in the middle. Will that unsettle Norwood?
Well, I think it does take a tremendous amount of strength out of the Norwood side, particularly with it combining with Paul McCormack and Ian Downsborough out of it.
And look at the tides are on. Norwood and Port Adelaide come on at the same time. Anthony Harvey leads them on, and there's Gary McIntosh, or a simile of Gary McIntosh. Do it for Macca, as he would do it for you, which is dead right. No one man more loyal to the Redlegs than Gary McIntosh. One small step for the Magpies, one giant leap towards four in a row. Of course, Port Adelaide in South Australia have won the last three.
Yes, and in what fashion they have done that as well. And you just can't write off Port Adelaide in finals. I believe they'll win this game today. Simply, I think, Chalmers in the ruck, Ginevar their captain. You know, he is the equal to McIntosh. Tremendous leader.
Now, the atmosphere here today, quite electric. 46,000 people. It was a sellout on Tuesday in Adelaide, as it was last year. Live coverage around the country, and Port Adelaide revel in this spirit.
Oh, they really do love it. There's no question about that. The spirit is what it's all about. To end up basically in front on the scoreboard on grand final day is the ethos of Port Adelaide.
And for our interstate viewers, Ken, what type of game will Port Adelaide play?
Well, they're very methodical, no doubt. They're hard at it, hard at the ball. They win the 50-50 balls, the body-on-body stuff. They really do intimidate you, and they simply put it straight down the middle through centre-half forward.
Norwood, on the other hand, their style of play, much more free-flowing and distributing the ball around.
Yes, a lot more link in the Norwood game plan, and of course they have a two-pronged attack in James West, who has won the most goals for the year, along with Malloy. So, you know, they've got good strength up forward, and the inclusion of Brett James, I think, will be very handy for them, particularly if Andrew Jarman is tagged out of it early. Jarman may start up forward even.
They all look very relaxed, Port Adelaide. They've been here before. There's only four players in this Port Adelaide side who haven't played in a premiership previously, and that should hold them in good stead. One of them, one of the leading players for Port Adelaide, of course, is their skipper, Tim Ginevar. He's played for 14 seasons. He's taken them to seven flags. He's the only player from the 84 Port Adelaide Norwood Grand Final, and we caught up with him during the week also.
Tim, another Grand Final. It's always big around Alberton this time of year.
Definitely, mate. And look, it's no different than any other Grand Final. More so, I think, playing Norwood. It's always been the arch rival, so I think a very important game coming up Sunday.
You've got a lot of experience, a lot of Grand Final experience. Do you think that'll make the difference come game day?
Well, we hope it does, actually, because we have got quite a few that have played in a lot of premierships, so on the day, I hope that does drag us through.
Your second semi-final must have given you an enormous confidence going into a grand final. You really had their measure at almost every level.
It was a very good game. I think that they had a good third quarter, and I thought that was a good game all around. So, look, 50-50 on the day, I think, Dave.
Now, we think back to the drubbing they gave you Anzac Day, and I suppose that must sit in the players' minds. There's payback time at Port Adelaide, isn't there?
Well, we believed at that time that the only way we could make up for that effort on Anzac Day was to win the grand final, so this is our time to pay it back.
Well, why is it that Port Adelaide grow another leg in finals? You haven't been the best team during the year, to be fair, but suddenly come finals, you just look a different side.
Well, that's happened the last few years, I suppose, David. We haven't been the best team all year, but then you win it on the day and that's all that counts.
The keys for you today, who do you think will be the match winners?
I think if Brett Chalmers can get on top in the ruck, I think he's very important. We've got to do our job in the midfield. And obviously you've got to kick enough goals, so the forwards are going to do a good job.
The crowd's obviously a factor. I think the Port Adelaide crowds probably are more vocal than any other.
Definitely, if we can get on top, and especially late in the game, they'll carry us over the line.
You confident of winning, Tim?
You've always got to be confident.
Port Adelaide are always confident. There's Tim Ginevar, regarded as their best player last year in the finals. And he is quite a character, along with Scott Hodges, probably the most influential player in Port Adelaide's finals assault in the last 3 years.
There's no doubt about that, but that confidence factor, like, there's no doubt, self-belief, you know, it really is what it's all about, that spirit to win finals.
Yes, well, the acting captain today for Norwood is Anthony Harvey, the brother of 97 Brownlow medalist Robert Harvey, the former St Kilda player sacked by you, Ken Sheldon. We might cover that when we come back from this interview with Anthony Harvey.
Harvey's feeling amongst the players seems to be terrific tonight.
Yeah, we've had a couple of good training sessions on the track this week, and we're really ready to go this week.
Has the Gary McIntosh situation affected you at all?
No, not at all. All the boys stayed really focused on the job at hand and just looking forward to this week.
You must have been disappointed with your second semi-final against Port Adelaide. You didn't play anywhere near your best.
No, we played in patches against Port in the second semi, which I think we just got to string four quarters together to beat them this week.
It appeared to me that you played two good quarters of football last week against Central District. You'll need to play four today to beat Port Adelaide.
Yeah, I think we're slowly getting better in a lot of areas that we need to work on. And I think we should just about be right for this week.
Is there any thought of payback? Port Adelaide defeated you in last year's preliminary final. It was tough. It was a grand final for the taking and they knocked you out of it and went on to win the flag. Is there any feeling amongst the players that you owe them one?
Well, we don't really look back at last year. We just sort of really stay focused on the job this year, and we're just really looking forward to having a good contest against Port Adelaide, which it would be a hard and fair contest.
1984 was the last premiership. Is this the year of the Red League?
I think so.
And a lot of people agree with him. Robert Harvey, what a champion he's been. Fourth in the Red League's best and fairest last year, Ken. He really has been a great pickup. Now, I said you sacked him, but you actually coached him. I misread what you wrote.
Look, he's an exciting youngster. He's just full of leadership qualities, he's a terrific young fella. His family will be here all today watching him, giving full support as they always have. And this kid, he really can play. One of the features to watch of him today is not only his running ability, but also the way that he quickly gives the ball off by hand or foot.
Now, you know what's required for AFL clubs. Is this fellow a candidate to be drafted?
I've always believed he has the talent to go on, but it's just a matter of an AFL side can basically slip them into their system. Like, he is a tremendous ball winner and has now lately developed tremendous leg strength, as you can see there as he kicks that ball.
We might invite Mark Naley to join us. Mark, the critical players for the Redlegs, there's one in screen.
It really is that midfield that's been the dominating feature of the Norwood players this year. Jarman in question, also Harvey. We're speaking about Tyson as well on the outer wing. But their big man strength also getting Aaron Keating back this week to assist Simon Eastor. That's going to be a big bonus also. But just don't be surprised that player in the screen there, Andrew Jarman, doesn't get picked up once again by Darryl Borlase, who has done a reasonable job over the last two encounters.
Thanks very much for that, Marcus. We go down to Rob Popplestone in the middle of the oval.
That DB down with me, of course, is the 1997 McGarry medalist in Brodie Atkinson. And Brodie, we're just talking off air and the butterflies are starting to happen in our stomachs and we've got no part of the game.
Yeah, it seems like you're playing today, just walking out here, and even before the game, walking to the stadium today, I'm pumped even for the players.
And back in 91, you can remember none of this.
No, as soon as I ran out of that race and going through someone singing then and before the game, the anthem, I didn't remember a thing.
Back to you. You're out here, of course, to toss the coin for the start of the 97 Grand Final. If we make our way out to the middle of the ground, we'll see Tim Ginevar from the Port Adelaide side and also Anthony Harvey, acting captain, of course, while Gary McIntosh has to miss one game through suspension. Brodie, of course, will toss the coin. And Brodie, I'll lend you that dollar, so if you could use that to toss the coin and we'll get this game underway. Brodie Atkinson, of course, is wishing both captains the best of luck, both Anthony Harvey and Tim Ginevar. And just for our viewers at home, out here in the centre of the ground, there is quite a strong breeze going to the left of screen. So you can see from that toss that Anthony Harvey from Norwood has won the toss and will kick left to the left of screen. So you'd imagine that Norwood will use that win to in that first quarter. Brodie Atkinson just wishes the umpires the best of luck. And Brodie, you've played against both these sides, Norwood and Port Adelaide. Have you got a tip after performing quite well against both Norwood and Port?
Very hard decision, really, because Norwood obviously been the form side of the competition all year, and Port Adelaide, you just can never knock them out of a finals contention. And after watching the reserves final a minute ago, when Port come from about 27 points down in three-quarter time, you'd have to say Port, but my heart's going with Norwood. Hopefully Norwood will get up.
Yeah, I tend to agree, and I suppose a lot of people do. Back in 1984, of course, it was Port and Norwood. They haven't met in 13 years, but all the signs are there that this is going to be a real ripper.
Look forward to some fireworks in about the first 10-15 minutes. I'm sure it'll be a typical Port Norwood grand final.
Good on you, Brodie. Thanks for that. Well done on 1997 for you, and all the best for 98. DB, a champion, no doubt about that. Brodie Atkinson.
And listen to the roar as the crowd get behind Port Adelaide and Norwood, the two traditional rivals of South Australia. It's a dream grand final, the first time since 1984, as we take you to Mark Naley and Ken Sheldon.
Yes, Ken, we just see there the Port Adelaide huddle before the start of this grand final.
You imagine what they're saying. They really, I mean, after that second semi-final effort, it really was a tremendous, coming down from 17 points down midway through that third quarter, end up winning by 22 points.
And the performances of their captain, Tim Ginevar, number one, was magnificent. Brett Chalmers had something like 17 or 18 marks and was sensational in the third quarter. He wears number 8 and will play in the ruck for Port Adelaide. And Darryl Borlase, the vice captain of the Port side, he took out number 10, Andrew Jarman for Norwood, tagged him out of the game in a tremendous display of disciplined football. Be interesting to see, Mark, also the performance, I think, of Simon Tregenza on the wing for Port Adelaide. I think his pace will be very critical.
It was pretty exciting there in that second semi-final. The player there in screen, Aaron Keating, he's had a very big week with Adelaide Crows. They've been out most night, but I know that he's dedicated to win another flag for the Norwood boys. With him also is young James, who was part of that celebration there in screen. So a pretty exciting week for those two players.
Well, there are three players. Aaron Keating in screen there, number 18. Brett James, who wear number 11, I think, for the Norwood side. And also Troy Bond, who will play for Port Adelaide. Those three players, look, it is a difficult assignment and history in the making for those two players to play in two premiership sides at this level. One of those three will do so, or two of those three possibly, but it really is up to the individual how they handle that mentally, and now really is showtime.
The umpires in this match, Kevin Chambers in his third grand final, he did 92 and 95, Ron Bettridge for his first, and Derek Woodcock for his first grand final. So well done to the men in white as we prepare for the opening bounce of the 1997 SANFL grand final. It's Port Adelaide and Norwood. Stay with us around Australia for the biggest match of the South Australian year. It's Keating in ruck from the right, Chalmers in ruck, the Port Adelaide champion who also double teams with the Crows. Chalmers goes around the corner and gets the first kick in the 1997 SANFL Grand Final. Tyson over the top of the ball, run down by Poulton, gets away a handball, and already it's a ferocious pace.
Already you can see Borlase has picked up Jarman in the midfield. Tregenza is on the outer wing with Obst, and on this wing, as we mentioned, we have Poulton and Tyson. So some critical matchups in the midfield.
Ball comes to ground. Borlase gets his first kick for the afternoon. It goes forward. The exciting player in Peter Burgoyne. Just inside the centre square. Takes a good safe mark. Will go back. Looking for Ambrose up forward. Goes one way, goes the other way, chips it up in front of Ambrose. Opportunity here, a good safe mark. Taken by number 5 for Nord, and Dale Fleming.
Very much underrated player, Fleming, and a very handy inclusion from the second semi-final for Norwood.
Jarman, oh, he took a swipe at Borlase, the umpire saw it. Now what's happening here? He's going to take the kick off him for sure. And will he report him? No, he gives him a warning and doesn't take the ball off him. So even though it didn't connect, the umpire getting on the job early and giving him a warning. James, grubber along the ground. Carr couldn't quite get back in time. Sujay Cook, this is Obst, the former Sturt player. What a great recruit he's been for the Redlands. He pushes it up to Malloy, the former Melbourne player. And now at the back door, Clayton, number 10 for Port Adelaide, just chips it away. Hasn't he been a prospect for the Magpies this year? Carter bounds down the grandstand wing. Two bounces, looks up, delivers it short, pushes it wide, and it was Bond undecided with Ambrose. Very little talk.
Yes, the kick was just, well, a little bit too high from Carter. Bond, no doubt, was in the slot to take that, and just the indecision caused the ball now to be out of bounds.
The ball to be thrown in, inside the 50-metre half circle for the Magpies. The ball's thrown up. Working hard was Treadray. Bombs in there also. Puts a tackle on Cunningham. Cunningham gets to his feet quickly. Gets the ball up towards the wing. Keating in front. Over the back was Chalmers. Two grabs. Should have been paid the mark. The umpire calls play on. Chalmers onto his left leg. Finds Clayton in the middle. Clayton across the ball lays. On the 15-metre line. He goes for the goals. Has he got the direction? He hasn't got the distance. But it's the first score for the afternoon.
It's a good build-up on the Port Adelaide side. Their midfield is linking well through centre-half forward.
As we go down to Rob Popplestone on the boundary.
There'll be a few changes for both sides on the interchange for Norwood, Rowe, Pascoe and Bassett. And for Port Adelaide, Pedler, Hahn and Rowan Smith.
Thanks, Rob, for that. Number 12 was Matthew Ashley, thumping the ball across. Youngster in only his 15th game. What a highlight for him.
at 20 years of age, and a good crowd here at Football Park, a sellout crowd today. Was sold out on Tuesday, and the SANFL have allowed a live telecast. And shortly we'll be crossing also to Western Australia. Tim Ginevar around the corner. The Port Adelaide skipper goes forward. Loose ball, Jarman. Quick hands, pushes out from the centre half back in Lachlan Bowman, who forces it wide. Out on the far side, Cunningham goes after Chalmers and gathers him in. Chalmers gets away the handball, but look at Cunningham. What desperate work. He gets it back in the direction of Simon Eastall, the former Richmond Reserves ruckman who has been dominant this year in the SANFL. And Carter taken across the line, and Roger James collected him.
You see here the high tackle against Feagard, actually. You see there the right hand of Feagard going high.
It's a pretty tough call there, I think, Ken. It was a good tackle there. I think Feagard was a player at the top that has given away the free kick. You see James going forward. Malloy's taken high. Umpires missed that. Quickly from Clayton. He's kicked, put the ball onto his boot. Unfortunately, couldn't keep it in. And again, the red legs will come forward.
And the reason the ball's in the red legs forward line is that man there in screen, he is leading by example with the pressure, the fierce pressure that he's putting on opposition. None more evident than that tackle on Brett Chalmers when he couldn't get the clean handball away.
Tyson across to Jarman. Jarman goes with the goal square. The ball still kept in. It's handball back to West. West throws on his boot. I think he's got it through. He has. It's been touched on the last line by the ever-experienced Roger Delaney. Desperation shown.
Northeast not able to take clean hands with the footy. Harvey with a quick inboard handball, and West snapped to the footy, but great desperation, and that's what it's all about. Absolute desperation at this stage of the game.
Roger Delaney, a veteran of six Port Adelaide Premiership flags, pushes it to Simon Tregenza, who had the kick smothered by Obst. Matthew Ashley forces it forward, but Tregenza goes off the ground. Now it's Tyson, also a former Richmond player, to half forward, and it's James West, 48 metres out. The angle's tight.
He should settle, though, and just put this to the slightly to the front of the goals, and the wing will carry it right to left on screen. Should be able to kick this goal, West.
James West recruited from Glenelg this year. After a disagreement with Glenelg coach Wayne Stringer, sprays that one to the point of the square, and look at this. Already the big men dominating the Port Adelaide defence. Feagert marks deep in defence. And it's hello and welcome to our viewers in Perth as you join us for the 1997 SANFL Grand Final. Your commentators Mark Naley, Ken Sheldon and David Mackay.
Cunningham goes forward. Again, the Magpie defence through Stephen Carter. Good grab. He goes back to Delaney, who comes out to Northeast. Northeast will go over the top to the running Tregenza. He's got time now. He takes one bounce. Good pressure from behind by Tyson. McGuinness is there with Dan Toshier. Tyson comes across. Jarman's there. Good hands. Under extreme pressure to Tyson. Tyson goes forward. Davey from the half-back line. The running half-back player, and Davey pushes it up towards centre-half forward. West again held by Delaney. Coming through hard was Clayton. From Burgoyne back to Delaney. Delaney kicks forward, looking for Bond.
Bond at half forward. Davey, who was pushing the ball forward, just escaped for a moment. And Bond goes towards Ambrose. It was over that player's head. Now it's Stephen Pitt, who had a stint at Collingwood last season. Davey forces it forward to Fleming, the former Fitzroy player. Now to Sujai Cook. The youngster just flicks it over the top and is collected as he does so. It's Obst streaking down the outer wing and forces a long ball in. But Feagert is just beautifully in control and forces it towards the line. Well, I think there was a free kick maybe there, Ken. I stopped mid-commentary.
Well, the crowd was certainly screaming for deliberately out of bounds there by Feagert. The left-hand palming the ball over the boundary line. The half-back line of Port Adelaide, magnificent so far.
East door up against Chalmers. Cunningham at ground level with Tim Ginevar. Some hands by James for trying to find Harvey. And Harvey will just seeing the ball over the line and down the boundary line. Rob Popplestone, what's the atmosphere like?
Oh, look, it's sensational down here now. There's no doubt about that. Certainly a grand final atmosphere. Capacity crowd of 45,000 people here. I tell you what, the instructions have gone out, though, to Simon Tregenza already on this grandstand wing to tighten up on Tyson. Tyson has had a sensational start to this game and certainly had the better of Tregenza. Only 7.5 minutes into this first quarter.
Thanks, Rob. You see the coach there on the screen. The Norwood coach, Peter Rohde. Norwood only losing three games this year and losing the second semi-final to the side they're playing this afternoon. The ball comes down. Borlase in there with Cook.
can see these ruck duels here in midfield. Darren Smith, the normal centre-half forward for Port Adelaide, will take these. The normal ruckman in Chalmers will sit down a kick and a half behind the play, right in the slot, right in the line of the two forwards in James West and Malloy for Norwood. So he's sitting back to left of screen about 70 metres.
Average age of these sides here this afternoon. We're looking for Port Adelaide. They've got an average age of 24.1, where Norwood have got an average age of 24.8. So really nothing between the two sides as far as age and or experience.
That doesn't really tell the true story though, Mark, does it? Because Port Adelaide have six players over 30, where Norwood, to my recollection, only have the one in Stephen Rowe, who's 31. Four, correction, you're quite right. James West, 31. Andrew Jarman, 31. Statsman Ian Mogridge just squares the ledger. Poulton taking the ground. Jarman throws out. It's his second throw for the afternoon. Got away with the second one too. They talk about a crow throw. Well, I think Jarman's made an art form, and James finishes it off, but he gets a point.
Some terrific tackling there by the Norwood side, evidenced again. And what a tremendous tackle by Bowman, who allowed James to run in. Should have slotted that goal. Bowman had effectively put the target shepherd on to give him space to settle.
Delaney brings the ball back in the member's side. He finds Paul Northeast. The awkward kicking action of Paul Northeast goes down further afield, finding Carter. Carter did well under a fair bit of pressure. Goes for the safety of the boundary line, realising we had two Nord opponents. Just about to be set upon, but Ken, once again, the Magpies going for the safety of the boundary line.
Well, I think this is where Port Adelaide have traditionally been stronger than Norwood, that these 50-50 contest boundary throw-ins, I think they do better at clearing the ball from these situations, so it's a good tactic from the Magpies.
Dan Toshier. Good mark. He's settled himself now. Look forward. He's got Keating calling for it. That's the direction he goes. The back is Chalmers. He should take this. He does. Good save, fans. A good opening by the Port Adelaide ruckman and Brett Chalmers.
Chalmers kick number three. Second mark for him, the big fellow, as Pitt flicks it out to Sujay Cook. The young 20-year-old drives it long and low. Malloy was the target, but missed the target comprehensively in the finish. And Feagan allowed to mop up beautifully again.
And again, evidence that Port Adelaide went under pressure. Simply put it to the safety of the boundary line. Very deliberate there, but well done by Nigel Feagan.
Comment, Ken Sheldon, former Carlton Premiership player and St Kilda coach, who joins us today as special comments. As Obst goes forward, Cunningham misses it, but look at this fellow. Not much pace, but a Dow defender, Paul Northeast, pushes it forward. Jerry Dancocchia, well, hasn't he been a champion for the Redlegs? Forces the ball towards Jim West. Delaney just wears him like a glove. Feagan flips it forward, and the umpire said he got one high, and the advantage allowed to fly. So play on the call as Poulton comes back through the middle. Oh, big fly. Bond went up but couldn't bring the ball down. No free kicks at the umpire, and Jarman pushes it back, flicks that one to Davey, gets it back in the double play and protects himself, but the ball was already across the line.
Tremendous athletic ability there, but not able to take the mark. But the wrong option by Poulton there. Had Delaney and others short of that contest, and Port Adelaide should have been able to take the ball forward on the overlap. So a missed opportunity.
Smith thumps the ball forward. Bowman at ground level gets a push in the back from Borlase. He wants to get the ball moving quickly. The player's in short. He decides to go long. Awkward kick. Clayton's there. The back is Deestor. Takes a great grab. Well judged. He's got Jarman running past. So Deestor kicks the ball forward. Again, some heavy body work between Paul Northeast and Malloy. Delaney, again, will see the ball out over the line. Looks up to the boundary umpire there, Ken.
Well, again, you can see here, just not able to control the football and eventually just putting it over the line. Good pressure by Anthony Harvey. Good defensive pressure in the forward line.
Chalmers tries to kick the ball off the ground. Brett James feeds it to Roger James in turn. Tyson, who goes towards the goals, but Northeast steadfastly defends and thumps the ball across the line.
Norwood are really the aggressors at this stage. They're initiating all here at Football Park at the moment, but they're not putting it on the scoreboard.
Feeding, and Chalmers. Chalmers thumps it down. Carr off to Ginevar. Ginevar, a high ball inside the 50-metre arc. Oh, Borlase did well. Harvey was sitting underneath it and had the sip. Tyson mops up defensively.
pushes it to Eastor, who goes deep in the pocket. The kick was disappointing. He played so beautifully well in the second semi-final, Simon Eastor. And there's just moments in a grand final when the side needs something.
The ball's to be thrown in. Keating is over the back. Cunningham, the running play, comes around his body. Couldn't bring it back far enough. And brings up his first score for the afternoon. So that takes Norwood now to 3 points. They lead Port Adelaide just a solitary point. So
Norwood missing out, goal face pressure. You've got to be able to drill those. They're money for old rope for players of that ability. And really, grand finals are all about making the most of the opportunities.
As we go down to Rob Popplestone on the boundary.
Thanks, DB. A change to be made for the Redlegs. Just 13 and a half minutes into this first quarter. Aaron Keating, Premiership player, just a week ago will have a spell, and coming on will be Pascoe.
Not a bad ploy, that. I think they're going to run Chalmers hard. Norwood, of course, can run the two big men. Oh, look at that, northeast. So Keating comes off at the 14-minute mark. You'd expect that two ruckmen will run hard at it in the first half particularly. Trying to take the sting out of Brett Chalmers' game. It's Figgett who's dominating the early part of this first term. Poulton up, and Pascoe just on the oval takes an easy chest mark.
But Pascoe, once again, goes towards centre-half forward. The jump from behind was delayed, but again, Paul Northeast, who really is having a purple patch at the moment. Anything's coming his way, he's taking and cleaning up. He's given the ball out wide to Clayton. Clayton looking for support. He's got his captain in Ginevar. Really making hard work of this, the Magpies. Quick kick out finds Dragenza. Dragenza will go down the line. He's got the running ball, Ace. He takes it, decides to play on. Onto his left boot, he brings it back. Up forwards, Ashley, couldn't take it. A good mark taken by Dan Toshier.
Dan Toshier, resolute in defence. Changes play here, good switch to Pitt.
As we go down to Rob Popplestone on the boundary again.
As Stephen Pitt leads the Redlegs out of defence, big news down here is Brett Chalmers is carrying an ankle injury. A doctor just went out to him on the oval. And as you can see, in just a few moments' time, Brett Chalmers will actually leave the ground. He's having trouble walking, so a big blow for the Port Adelaide side.
Well, that was always the danger, Kim, wasn't it, for Port Adelaide going in with one recognised ruckman.
Yes, it would have to be Richard Ambrose possibly now that takes up centre stage in the midfield. Pedler go to full forward possibly, but that is a big loss for Port Adelaide, a real dent in their chances here today.
Jarman flicks it out to Brett James, in turn has Pascoe. The big fellow lumbers along, kicking the forward line. Delaney just a little nudge. Oh, the umpire's picked it up too. Pushing the back, says umpire Chambers. And West will kick for goal from 40 metres out. The angle is very tight.
Port Adelaide, it looks, have elected to put Warren Treadray into the ruck, which is something that he's used of a little bit. He has been there during parts of the year.
So Jim West, the Farmer medalist in 97. Oh, look at the kick. He's kicked it like a Farmer medalist. What a team lifter that one is. He had 77-28 coming into today. That's his 78th. And kicked like a specialist full forward.
Well, they're goals that you just love to see. West had a prior opportunity about 5 minutes ago where he sprayed it off the side of his boot. He's really taken control of himself and just swatted that through for a tremendous goal. Sign of a good player is you don't miss from the same position twice. West was able to do that to bring up the first goal of this grand final.
The 16.5-minute mark of this first quarter, Norwood by 8 points. The ball's down, Treadray up against Pascoe. Treadray takes it out of the air, quickly onto his right boot. Back there is Bowman for the Redlegs. Again, he kicks the ball quickly out wide, looking for Obst. First there is the captain for the Magpies in Ginevar. Just taps the ball forward, will receive a free kick. The ball will come back. So no player on the mark, he decides to play on. Kicks it high, coming back. Good, strong, safe mark by Troy Clements.
Clements, Dan Tokia, Fleming, very crucial in intercepting the ball with Port Adelaide's thrust at this early stage of the game. Been terrific.
No question, this is a battle of defences. Dan Tokia, short. Fleming running down the field hard, marks it at centre-half forward. Well, I think he was looking to play on now, does so successfully. Dan Tokia from defence, pushes it along to the square. Oh, what a kick from Jerry.
Goal.
I think he might have put it through. He has, says the umpire. So Jerry Dan Tokia kicks his first goal for the season in the grand final.
You can see here, very close to touch, but the umpire deemed that it was full points. And what just tremendous discipline run from Dan Tokia. He intercepted the ball in front of the scoreboard,
basically 150 metres away from where he launched the ball towards goal. Great run from defence from the experienced number 36.
22 games for Jerry this year without a goal. He remedies that in the grand final.
14 points to Norwood. They extend their lead. 18-minute mark in this first quarter. Ginevar quickly onto his left boot. They need a score out of this. Out comes Ambrose. Both players overrun it. Again back there is number 26, is Stephen Pitt. Knocks the ball forward to Dan Toshier. Dan Toshier back to Harvey. Harvey's throwing his boot out. Has kicked the ball out over the boundary line. And just a few of the Port Adelaide players there just letting him know that he's made a mistake. So Bond for the Magpies. Tucked deep in this pocket. Already a premiership player for the Adelaide Crows this season. So Bond looks to the top of the square. It's a good kick. Good mark taken front by Paul Ace. He's bringing it back. He's paid the mark. Paul Ace played on, Ken.
No, I don't think he heard the whistle. I think that's what actually happened.
I think you'd have to ask the umpire. That was... It's a very interesting call.
As we go down to Rob Popplestone on the boundary.
Thanks for that. An interchange will be made in just a moment. Coming off will be Simon Peddler. On is Scott Hahn.
So ball is directly in front, only 20 metres out. It's very close to the man, the mark. But he's kicked his first goal for the afternoon and a much needed one for the Magpies.
Perhaps ball is not thinking that he had cleanly marked the football. You see here on replay. Front position, good stuff by Borlase. No doubt it was a mark, and no doubt he played on, so. He might have thought the ball was spoiled. The umpire.
I think Balme might have his hand to it first with the spoil. That's why he played on.
Can't take him back off the scoreboard, fellas. It's an 8-point ball game in favour of the Redlegs. We're 20 minutes into the first term of the 97 grand final. Treadray, who really has lifted a cog or two since going to the ruck, pushes it forward. Now Treadray again. Handballs back, concedes ground to Clayton. They're building the Magpies. It's Ginevar forcing it over the top. Tregenza. A long bomb in, and it's Ambrose and Fleming. And Pitt dropped into the hole, did it beautifully. Forces the ball towards the boundary line where Jarman flicks it forward. Hobbs now, the speedster, can take off. He's 26 years of age, and Ken Sheldon likes him. I can promise you that. No mark in the midfield. Tyson crashes through, feeds to Cunningham. He's been a revelation, this kid. Back from a knee reconstruction in March. He's only played the two games in the seniors. And he's kicked four already, four important goals in the finals. As Pascoe pushes it in long, Delaney West. Delaney thumps it down. Harvey went after it, gathers it in. Oh, it's taken away. And Matthew Ashley heads towards the boundary line. That one's out of bounds on the full.
Listen, you can see by the paper, the wind blowing strongly right to left. Just taking that ball for the second time out on the full in that pocket.
We just saw there in screen, Brett Chalmers has gone off. Very heavily strapped ice pack on his, looked like his right knee there. As the ball comes to ground, to Cook. In there again is Ashley, taken high. The umpire calls play on to Feagert. Feagert's got Smith down on the wing. That's the direction he goes. Good mark by Smith. He wants to get the ball moving quickly onto his left leg. He's got the running bomb to take it and turn. He does. Player further down the field is McGuinness. And really, they are going wide, Ken. Oh, they are keeping possession.
A brilliant exhibition of foot disposal.
So McGuinness hasn't quite got the carry
until the one that mattered. Final kick. Final kick into where the bloke can have a shot at goal. Just needs to be accurate.
Sorry, Ken, there. Coming through is once again is Ashley. Pushed it up. Hahn couldn't take it. Davey has, and he will clear.
The kick is a long one. Pascoe at half forward spills the centre. Well, Cook gathers it in, force it forward. Oh, I think it was clever. Pushed it down towards the line, and Sujo Cook gives a good contest with Carr.
Feagert here, like he has just been enormous, playing at centre half back, the best man on the ground at this early stage of the game, just chopping off everything.
Ball comes back in, it's Pascoe, front position. Treadray forced himself into the contest, did well. Harvey gets it out the back door. Around the corner goes Sujai Cook. And look at this, Malloy, clean bowl, missed with the bounce. Ginevar working hard in defence. flips it up. Pelton underneath the door. Good mark, young fellow. He's only young, 20 years of age and 20 games, but he's made an impact.
He certainly has. A couple of nervous errors early, but he now seems he has settled and showing his real ability.
I have been impressed with Jared Pelton. We saw him, I think it was Anzac Day, was his first clash where the Magpies had their biggest losing margin by 122 points that day. But we knew there that there was a champion in the making. You see Bowman on his left leg, kicks it forward. Up there was James West, couldn't take it. It was Pascoe, figured again, clears it. And Bond couldn't quite keep it in.
So it really has been the half-back lines of both teams. Figured, Clayton, Northeast. Carter until going off with an ankle injury. Chalmers, I should say. Carter's been tremendous also at halfback for Port.
So Nord by 8 points. Harvey comes across, he flicks the ball towards James. James is gang tackled by Ball Ace and also Tregenza. That was Ashley, number 12 there. Had no opportunity to get rid of the football. The umpire will bounce the ball. Members wing, East door, James takes it, through comes Ball Ace. Ball Ace again throws the ball onto his boot. There's no time. Willing to control the kick. Good knock forward there by McGuinness on the bomb. He needs to go over the top. He doesn't. He goes for the kick himself. Maybe a little bit selfish. Bring up a behind.
Well, only Troy Bond can answer that one. He might not have seen Ambrose, but from here it so easily should have went over the top to Ambrose on his own. Just a right of screen. In the goal square.
It's Pitt with the ball at half-back, hugging the boundary line. Here's a penetrating kick, this young fellow. Tregenza and Obst in a contest. A good bustle by Tregenza brings in possession of the ball inboard to Matthew Ashley, who's working hard in this first term. A high one to half-forward. Ambrose sits, but look at this. Lachlan Bowman, they're double-playing Ambrose successfully, so they've got two dropping into the hole and giving Fleming great support. Harvey forced it forward. Eastall wasn't quite prepared for it. Flicks it out wide to Todd Davey, around the corner, and he's upended as he dispatches the kick. It's an FAD, and Cunningham has the ball 45 metres out directly in front, and Carter at times, Ken, a little undisciplined.
Well, that was possibly soft, but there's no doubt that the hands were high from Carter, so the umpire deemed it downfield.
Smother for the kick has got to come in low. Cunningham, who played two games in the reserves, and then the second semi-final where he kicked two, the preliminary final where he kicked two, goes long to goal, and this time he misses. He's got 2 points, the young Rover, the best and fairest from 96, and I think there's a few AFL clubs having a good look at him.
So another missed opportunity for Norwood.
Delaney lays the ball onto himself. He comes towards the grandstand side. Pascoe, uncontested, got rid of Carter. Takes a good mark, so he settles himself. Got the player and Harvey in the pocket. Decides to go towards the top of the goal square. Going back is West. An infringement has been found by the umpire. Which way will it go? Oh. Carter once again. It's a Feagert.
Yeah, I think it's against Feagert there, just to right of screen. It pushed Eastall in the middle of the back.
So the player with the ball, Simon Eastall, puts it on its way. He's brought up his first goal of the afternoon, and once again, Norwood now move on to 3-4. They lead Port Adelaide 1-2.
It was good play by Pascoe, a late inclusion into the side. Ian Downsborough not able to take his position because of an ankle. Really a soft free kick there, it looked on screen, but the umpire again, a lot closer than we are. So I suppose it's even. Ball Ace at one end, now Easter at the other. Arguable whether they should have been given the opportunities to kick those goals.
27 minutes in and a 14-point ball game. The Redlegs enjoy the lead, but it's Tregenza kicking it forward into space and a mark at centre-half forward. It's Hahn feeding it off and tripping over was Ball Ace, who's already kicked one. Hahn goes back after it. James gathers him in, but Clements kicks it off the ground. Heading towards the boundary line, I think he'd be quite happy to take the ball to touch. Well, he made out like he lost his footing, which he probably did. But it wasn't a bad disguise, was it? That one had a moustache on it.
And glasses, perhaps. Sorry, fellas.
We weren't going to comment. Bowman comes through, goes over the top, takes his own handball onto his left boot. He goes wide, looking for Pascoe. Pascoe will be first there. The ball doesn't favour Pascoe, does for Feagott. The ball smothered by James. And out of bounds. So Norwood defenders really running out free under no pressure. Port Adelaide coach Stephen Williams, the Williams family, been involved with the club for many games.
Yes, his father Foss coached the Magpies to 9 premierships. Stephen won his first flag in his first year last year. It's a great tradition.
The Norwood match committee observing from the coach's box here at Football Park. There's a ball thrown in. Pascoe from behind used his strength and his size. The ball ends up with Cook. Cook kicks it up and Nigel Feagott takes a safe mark. He wants to get the ball moving quickly. He does. He finds Northeast once again. Northeast thumps the ball onto his boot. At the back, it's like Jared Poulton. Poulton comes to ground. He's taken by Jims West. And Jimmy West, long way down from full forward, Ken.
He'd been chasing Delaney, so it's good defensive ethic from West. A renowned goal kicker. He's prepared to do the other things as well, and then he did delay an effective tackle. So a big turnaround for Norwood.
Eastall wins the tap, but Ginevar, the opposition rover, wins it. And the siren sounded. It's quarter time in the 1997 SANFL Grand Final. The Redlegs can enjoy the lead by 14 points.
Yeah, 7-3. They really have been the dominant factor, and particularly the early part of this first quarter where they did initiate everything. They really did lead the way in the one percenters, the tackles, the smothers, the harassers, but they were not able to finish it at the goal, Fraser.
So quarter time scores here at Football Park. The grand final for 1997. Norwood, they're 3-4, 22. They've got a margin over Port Adelaide. They're 1-2, 8. And you're watching it at home, live and exclusive to ABC Sport.
Points the margin at quarter time in the SANFL Grand Final, and one player who helped the Redlegs get into the Grand Final was Simon Eastall, who was knocked out in the second semi-final. He played a brilliant game, probably his best game for the Redlegs in the preliminary final today. Lines up in the ruck for the Redlegs. Before the match, I caught up with his fiancée, Alex Harding, on her thoughts about the big fella's preparation.
With me is Alex Harding, the girlfriend of Simon Eastall. Fiancée, Alex, isn't it? You're due to get married.
6 weeks.
Now tell me, what's he been like this week?
Not too bad. Concentrating very hard.
Now, I suppose you were with him at Richmond, the days when he got delisted. I suppose they were part of the low times, the bad times, but this week is part of the good times.
Very much so. He was looking to give up football after Richmond, but he's very happy at Norwood.
Has he settled in and been made welcome there?
Loves it. Wouldn't leave.
What's been the difference in his form? Because he really has blossomed as a player since coming to the parade.
He feels important. He's got a spot at the club, and I think that makes him feel... feel wanted.
Now, how did you feel in the second semi-final when he was knocked out, carried off for the ground? You wouldn't have felt too happy at that point.
No, I was a little bit concerned because I knew that all he wanted to do was play in the final series, so I was hoping that he would be okay for the following week.
And has Simon been happy with his form?
Yes, but as long as he continues it this week, he'll be more than happy.
Tell us about the build-up this week. Has he been a little crankier than usual, or is he generally pretty relaxed?
No, he's been working, so that's kept him out of my hair pretty well. So, no, he's been very good, I think.
Now, he works as a phys ed instructor at Executive Fitness Management.
That's
does
right.
That help him in his match preparation?
He does. He's got a lot of... we've got a lot of Port supporters there that have been putting him back in his spot all week, so he's had a pretty good preparation, I think.
And how will you celebrate tonight if you win?
He'll just be thrilled. I think Norwood will just be very happy and very bubbly, so it'll be good.
Alex, thanks for your time and good luck with the wedding.
Thank you.
Yes, very good luck with the wedding, Simon. Lucky man, let me say that. As we go to the highlights from the first quarter, 3 great goals to the Redlegs in a tough first term.
We just see Jerry Tantoshi just running it out from defence. Maybe Jarman here, Ken. Wasn't quite sure whether he made contact or not.
And there was the that was deemed a high tackle by Feagott in the left-hand pat. You can see there, quick handball in by Harvey. Just touched in desperation by Roger Delaney, right on the last line of defence. Fleming had run well down from defence, as had Dan Tocchi on the last line of defence also for Norwood, and kicked a fine goal.
You just see there, big Roger Delaney. This could be his swan song, 1997 Grand Final. There are rumours about that he may retire.
And you can see this one really questionable. Borlase had played on, but the umpire brought that kick back. Perhaps... sure what the ruling was there.
Well, the ruling was that I think the umpire paid the mark, and Bolaser thought that he hadn't been paid and played on, so he gave him the benefit of the doubt, and it resulted in a goal. It was Port Adelaide's only goal for the quarter, and I don't think Stephen Williams would be all that pleased with the Magpies' first term, as we go down to Rob Popplestone to find out exactly what the coach said.
Thanks for that, DB. Yes, behind me, of course, Port Adelaide are very concerned about the loss of Brett Chalmers, and rightly so. But Steve Williams has passed that off and given the responsibilities to the other members of the side to lift, and they'll need to lift too. Although, down here in the centre of football park, I can tell you the breeze is building considerably, and I'd expect that Port Adelaide will play a more direct game than they played in the first quarter, when, as we saw, they tended to play around the boundary lines. Norwood, on the other hand, very keen to keep on going directly down the middle of the ground, use their advantage of the big men in Pasco and Keating and also Eastor. I think you'll find Eastor may have a rest early in this quarter again, or even Pasco, but definitely I'd expect Keating to start the ruck against Treadray. They've said that they believe they've got better running players, especially around the midfield, and if they're prepared to run, there's certainly an area that Port Adelaide are deficient in at this moment, as Port Adelaide try to, of course, cover that loss of Brett Chalmers. But at this stage, I think the game is a lot more even than it reflects on the scoreboard, because Port Adelaide will be kicking over the aid with the aid of a strong breeze.
Quarter time score here at Football Park in the 97 Grand Final. Norwood lead the charge. They're 3-4-22, Port Adelaide are 1-2-8.
And the goal kicker so far today, we see Borlase for the Magpies has one. For Norwood, Dan Toshi has got one from a half-back flank. Eastor playing at centre-half forward has got one. And also West, the full forward, has got one. And Ken, the stats here this afternoon, fairly even in most departments, except maybe for the handballs.
Yes, I guess slightly overall in favour of Norwood, as is the scoreboard. They have been dominant. I think the Borlase Jarman factor, Jarman clearly on top there in the midfield. And I think also now the move of Pasco to centre-half forward has been pretty critical to their scoreline.
The umpires just getting themselves ready for the start of the second quarter here in the 1997 Grand Final. It's a good 14-point margin. Aaron Keating must have came off there, fellas, have a bandage put under a cutlet. And siren goes to the start of the second quarter. Warren Treadray up against Aaron Keating. Umpire Ron Bedridge puts the ball down. Good bounce. Keating over the top. Coming through is Harvey. Very direct. Kicks the ball towards full forward. Malloy up against Northeast. Cook takes it. Malloy again. Second effort. Cook will come in, as will West. And will be taken to ground.
Magnificent tackling there by Paul Northeast. He was the one that instigated the defensive spoil. The ball come to the front, then he followed up and laid a very aggressive tackle.
At the bounce. Dead heat that one. Pasco probably won it. Sujai Cook feeds it off to Pasco again. Now Roger James, well, he just left that one behind, and Dragenza picked up the loose scrum, turned it around the corner, and Bond, with his blistering pace, runs onto it and goes forward. He just lost his balance. And a free kick. I didn't see what the umpire indicated, but maybe it's deliberately across the line. I think it might have been. There you go. Clements, recruited from Woodville West Torrens. Been a pretty happy recruit too. No contest there.
So the matchups across the field very similar as they were in the first quarter. Not a great deal being done on the interchange by either coach at this stage.
Ball thrown in. Treadray tries to knock the ball forward. He finds Ashley, who gives the ball across to Ginevar. Ginevar goes up forward. Great courage shown by the Iceman in Hahn. So Hahn, grandstand wing, goes towards centre-half forward. Coming out in front again is Fleming, in front of Ambrose. Takes a good mark. Gets the ball moving quickly. Kicks it very high and finds Harvey back where the ball started from.
It's a tremendous play by Fleming. Anticipated that kick in and really did attack the ball.
The umpire is just trying to keep charge of this game. And played in good spirit. Played with plenty of desperation, played with plenty of intensity. As we see the Magpie captain and Tim Ginevar receive the free kick for a throw from James.
Matthew Ashley. A long bomb. Well, Keating misjudged that comprehensively. I think there was three or four other players who did. Turby's a lob right in the middle of the pack. Dan Tokia feeds it out to Pitt. Pitt's been as calm as a cucumber today. It's a high one. A difficult one for any forward. Pasco pushes a chance to Fegan. Outstanding at centre-half back. He really has dominated that position. marks deep in defence.
Apart from probably a 10-minute burst by Pascoe late in that first quarter, but it is shaping as a very, very good duel.
Darren Smith paddles it back. Poulton dispossessed. Burgoyne off the ground. Carter runs onto it. This is where Port Adelaide are good. They push the ball out and give themselves some space. Carter, with sheer strength, gets through traffic. Pushes the ball towards centre forward. Jarman and Borlase. It was Jarman, the defender, this time Harvey, to Keating, the little man to the big man, and the big man's upended and threw it. And it's a free kick to Port Adelaide.
He's undecided there. Some indecision in Keating's mind, and he went to, well, to evade the oncoming Port Adelaide player. But Ashley, he is a terrier.
Well, you two blokes being rovers would know that a good rover never handballs to a ruckman.
This kid here, number 12, he really, well, he has a lot to offer, I think. He's a very, very determined young player.
Matthew Ashley, two goals in the second semi-final. 7 goals, 3 for the year, and that one's a floater. Oh, it's got there. It's just got the legs. Excuse the pun, it's a magpie goal. And it's through for Matthew Ashley's first.
And coming up in typical Matthew Ashley fashion, able to execute the tackle on the big man Keating. Dean throwing the ball by the umpire, was rewarded the free kick, went back, settled, and kicked that from outside 50. As a rover, that is a tremendous goal.
So Matthew Ashley, it's his first goal for the afternoon. We're back in the centre of the ground. 14 plays, 22. North still hang on to their margin. The ball's knocked forward. Ginevar's first there to receive it. Quickly, once again, onto his boot. Comes out to Burgoyne. Couldn't take it. McGinnis knocks the ball back towards Burgoyne. Wasn't quite ready for it. Again, Burgoyne, with a bit of magic, goes back to McGinnis. But North defence, once again, led by Troy Clements. Enough pressure to get the ball over the boundary line.
Some exquisite skills there being displayed by those two players, McGinnis and Burgoyne.
Darren Smith, Keating back after it, gives it off to Cunningham, who flipped it out. Now heads back after it again, but Ginevar just dives on top and holds it in.
Well, that's what it's all about. Tim Ginevar, number one, just blocking the ball up. Very physical in his approach, very committed to winning that football, and if you can't win it, you certainly can take the man out.
We are 5 minutes into the second quarter. And it's an 8-point ball game. Borlase forces it forward. That was Pitt. And the line found.
Treadray, the player, chasing the football there. Playing in the ruck now for Port Adelaide at the expense of Brett Chalmers, who left the ground in the first quarter with an ankle injury.
Ball's thrown in. Pascoe up against Treadray. James cleverly soccers the ball forward. Out comes Nigel Fegan, soccers the ball again. Offset time, Jarman only found Ginevar. Ginevar across the Carter, last year's Jack Odie medalist in the 1996 grand final for the best player on the field. As the ball once again is held up on the Rednecks' half forward line.
Tremendous desperation by Todd Davey to be able to win that loose ball and hold it up for a ball up situation where it clearly could have been freely into the Port Adelaide's forward line.
Smith taken down, Borlase over the top of it. With him is Cook for the Redlegs.
Craig Balme, the man that we saw at the opening who figured so prominently in the 84 grand final, brother of former Norwood coach Neil Balme. And if you're from Western Australia, you missed that little bit of footage that we showed where Tim Evans, the Port Adelaide full forward, and Craig Balme chested it out and did a little bit more at the opening of the 84 grand final, the last time these two sides met in a grand final.
Clements.
Yes, you like him, don't you, Ken?
Pretty handy.
Pretty compact player, very rarely makes a mistake. It was Harvey handballing it off to Davey. Davey under pressure is just pushed as he dispatches the kick, and it's out of bounds on the full.
So good pressure by both sides. Putting it on the opposition while they have the ball.
Treadray, hasn't he just found a little bit of something? Since Chalmers went off, Treadray has really come to the fore. Brett James, taken by Hahn, gets away the handball. Tregenza and Obst, two speedsters go at it. And I know, Ken, you're pretty keen on him.
Oh, I like the pace of Obst.
But he is, what, 26 years of age. I'm not sure that he's going to be taken by an AFL club. He's certainly important at this level. And around the corner, no, so the umpire was a throw. It will come back.
slight agitation there by Ken, by the umpire. The ball had well passed that contest before he blew his whistle. Down the boundary, Rob Popplestone.
Thanks, Miles. A change in the ruck for Norwood will happen in just a few moments' time. Keating will come off for a spell as he did in the first quarter, and coming back on is Simon Eastall.
So Roger Delaney at left leg. He goes out wide to find northeast, trying to create a loose man. He takes two bounces, has time for a 30, decides to kick the ball towards centre-half forward. Burgoyne couldn't quite get the jump. Cook's there to clean up. With him is Davey. Some good hands there by Cook to find Davey. Malloy has to sit. He too. The players just not judging their marks here, or their flies at least this afternoon. And we see Treadray clean up and go towards Borlase.
Just wonder, Kim, whether that wind is a bit stronger than we've given it credit for.
There's no doubt about that. Robbie Popplestone alluded us to that before. The breeze strongly to the left-hand side of screen.
Borlase, kick number four. Three marks, so he's been good in the air. And Lachlan Bowman thumps that one across the line. Now, Borlase and Jarman, Ken, that's been a pretty interesting duel.
So I think Andrew Jarman is clearly on top at the moment. I think he's quite a bit more of the football. But again, Jarman, every time he does get the footy, Borlase is very close proximity, so a lot of pressure being put on him.
So another bounce as players unable to sort it out. Now there's the wind socket on the outer side of Football Park. And that really is a due south breeze. It seems to be favouring strongly the left of screen, the end of which Port Adelaide are kicking to, as Hahn dispatches one into space. Oh, Lachlan Bowman juggled it. McGuinness applied just the right amount of pressure, and Fleming, now forced to go it alone, does so successfully. A high one, Keating back. Oh, good courage, big man. Feeds it off to Obston. They're setting up the run now. Cunningham has time to steady and deliver it forward, but oh, he's miskicked it. As we go down to Rob Popplestone on the boundary.
Thanks, DB. Down here, Eastall still waiting for Keating to come off the ground, but also a change will happen in a few moments' time for Port Adelaide. A peddler will come back onto the ground, and Hahn will leave the ground as the Magpies go forward again through Carter.
Carter gives it across to his captain, and Ginevar. Ginevar's got the running Ambrose out in front, but a great mark from behind by Dale Fleming.
He's playing just as well as Fegan at the other end, Mark.
That's his fifth mark to Fleming. His opponent, Richard Ambrose, a full forward, has yet to touch the football. As we see Norwood again, clearing from defence. Dantosia looking for James. Tregenza will clean up. It's a mistake here. We'll go over the top. He doesn't. Goes to the short kick. Couldn't find Bond. And again, the Norwood defence will clear.
A loose one. Eastall, who was dominant in the second, in the preliminary final, was knocked out in the second semi. Harvey. Now this is what they need, the Redlegs. Their game is running. It's a powerful running game. And now they're setting it up. Clements from half-back comes along the grandstand wing. A little bit of kick. Well, perhaps we should give credit to Clayton, who chopped it off, made the angle pretty well. Northeast comes inboard. Treadray needs support. Gets it back to Northeast in the double play. And further afield, they've switched the direction of play yet again, Kid. That's what you alluded to at the start of the match.
Yes, particularly through this fellow Delaney, they are very methodical at their switch of play out of defence. Their use of the ball from here on in has to be crucial.
The magician in ball, Ergoyne goes forward. A couple of Port players clash from behind, and McGuinness is hurt.
And it is crucial, the use of the ball from half forward in, like they've been chopped out. Both defences are right on top.
Quick hands and tight. Obst kicks it high. It should run out over the line. It's not. It's kept in by Tom Carr. No, it's not. He's quite prepared to see that over the line. We've seen McGuinness there, Ken. A little bit of duress after taking one of his own players out there on the half forward line.
He played so wonderfully well in last year's grand final. I think he really would like to have set himself, but hasn't been amongst the action so far. Brett James. Well, that's Roger James, correction. Claimed by Carr.
A very, very good tackle too, able to dispossess James, the ball then falling to ground and bouncing back under him for a ball-up situation.
So we're 12 and a half minutes into the second quarter. It's Port Adelaide trailing by 8 points. The Redlegs enjoy the lead. Ginevar sets out after a pit there and dead heat.
Port Adelaide have to find a forward with the use of this breeze. Smith now back at full forward. I think a very good move by coach Stephen Williams. Perhaps Treadray now, who is finding his touch in the midfield, could be changed with Ambrose.
Carr cleverly intercepts the ball being moved across, then goes for the safety of the boundary line. He finds that, just beating Andrew Jarman, this year's McGarry medalist, joint McGarry medalist with Brody Atkinson. Good healthy crowd here supporting local football in South Australia. Really has been a tremendous week. The Adelaide Crows last week winning.
Ooh. It's been a double benefit, hasn't it? Because traditional rivals Port and Norwood haven't played in the big one since 84. And the Crows winning and a Port Norwood grand final, you really couldn't ask for anything more. West thought he'd marked it, but Borlase steals the crumb, drives it out into the midfield where Obbs battles with Tregenza, flicks it forward. And the umpire said there's a free kick. Obbs was held but not in possession.
Yeah, beautiful decision by umpire Betridge. You can see there on replay. He's grabbing the Guernsey.
So Obbs switches the play, brings it out wide. Out on the lead. Oh, well done, Roger Delaney. Just nudged West underneath that one. And going forward, it's Pedler. Oh, and he earned that one. No doubt about that.
Well, look at that.
What do you reckon?
Beautiful.
Okay, the elbow was high, and that's what umpire Betridge just talked to Clements about. It wasn't perhaps that he was so late, he was just untidy, and it's a 50-metre penalty. So the umpire got a good look at... argue that he was trying to punch the ball, but it certainly looked untidy at best.
And with those type of things, they have to be effective. There's now Pedler, who just has to regain his composure and put this through to create a lot of damage.
Well, he wouldn't
for
have
that
a lot
indiscretion.
Of, wouldn't have a lot of confidence. In six games this year, he hasn't kicked a goal.
Hold back him, David.
All right, I think you might from there. But he has kicked 30 goals in his career, so he knows how to kick them, but just not this year. And again, another player in the grand final gets his first goal for the season.
Pedler, a renowned forward, started his career as a brilliant forward. A lot of things were expected of him. He had to take a backward step, perhaps, before he eventually takes some forward. He is still only a very young player and has played a bit in defence this year. His first goal, as David mentioned, but a great deal of experience up forward through his career, relatively to speed.
So 15 and a half minute mark of the second quarter. Norwood by 2 points. Back in the middle, Eastor up against Treadray. Then Rover and Ginevar, the seven-time premiership player for the Magpies, gets the kick out. Dan Tossier tried hard. Players throwing themselves over the football. McGuinness and also James go head-to-head. Looks like McGuinness has given away a free kick.
Doesn't look fit to me, Ken. McGuinness, he just seems to be working hard but struggling.
25-metre penalty against McGuinness.
One kick, one handball, one mark. And he seems to be in a bit of discomfort with an injury.
Bowman goes short. James is left free. Has time to find West. Should have taken that chest mark. Under no pressure from behind by Delaney. Had time to take it. Goes wide to Treadray. Didn't hit the target. Eastall will come in. Supported by Cunningham. Cunningham on his left leg will find Cook. So Cook, outside of 50, chips it high. And the back's Pascoe. Down is Harvey. Harvey over the top of Delaney. Harvey's first goal for the afternoon. And Norwood hit back. And down the boundary line, Rob Popplestone, what have you got for us?
Thanks for that, Niles. Just as the Red Legs going to attack, I can tell you that the full forward in Malloy has left the ground. Scott Bassett will come on for the Red Legs. And at a crucial stage, Norwood have again hit the front.
You can see here the kick by Mark Clayton. One of his few mistakes. He has been an outstanding player so far for Port Adelaide, but that one a very costly turnover. Cunningham, excellent left foot disposal. Cook putting the ball to forward, and Harvey being where good rovers should be is able to crumb this. You can see him there at the front of that pack and square, and then able to just read it beautifully.
The Red Legs punch, Port Adelaide counter punch. Two heavyweights go at it. We're 18 minutes into the second quarter. Umpire Betridge sorts them out again. It's an 8-point ball game. Borlase in screen. Jarman, his direct opponent. fair amount of experience between those two players. East out, dumps it down, but Ginevar reads it beautifully, pushes it forward. Clements tried to thump it wide, but it sits nicely for Bond, who slipped at the crucial stage, and Clements claims him. That's holding the ball.
Correct decision there. Surprisingly, a number of players have lost their footing in crucial situations.
Fleming comes out from defence. Pascoe's there, so is Treadray, who really has stood up so far since regular ruckman and Brett Chalmers has been taken off with, looks like it was a knee injury. The young 18-year-old broke his arm this year, taking his time to get back. Played his best game, I believe, last or fortnight ago in the second semi-final. He's doing a serviceable job. This is Obst over the top to the running Davey. Davey can go further afield. He does that to find Tyson. Tyson somehow kept control of the football over there to Cunningham. Cunningham's taken by Ginevar. The ball spills out to James, and James has gone for holding the ball. Great tackling by the Magpie in midfield.
When you look at that, the tackle there of Ginevar, then of Clayton, it's magnificent strength, and it basically is a 100-metre turnaround when you consider, hadn't that tackle been effective, it would have been in Norwood's forward line. However, now it's coming out of the Port Adelaide forward line.
Pip to Jarman is good play to Cunningham. Three of their experienced players combining. Delisted a couple of years ago by Geelong, this young fellow. His father played in the 61 Hawthorn Grand Final, so I wonder whether the Hawks won't look at him under the father and son rule. And this fellow, Pascoe, had a stint at Collingwood. Well, he spent some time in the reserves this year, hasn't played much senior football, but he can be an impact player, and the long raking left foot drives it in towards full forward. Bassett tried to mark Harvey, flicks it back, Sujai Cook runs onto it, but Northeast, who's been solid as a rock, tries to force it out. Brett James handballs it wide, but look at this, Poulton tripped or stumbled, feeds it out to Matthew Ashley, who heads towards the boundary line. There was no other option.
A very disciplined kick by Ashley. Looked upfield, realised that all his options were covered. Dan Tocchia had blocked up his vision, so he simply put the ball wide to the space, to the safety of the boundary.
Ball thrown in, out of wing. Eastall uses his body against Treadray. In there also is Cunningham. The umpire, once again, will come in and ball it up. It's an 8-point margin, still to the Redlegs. Umpire Betridge puts the ball down. Eastall cleverly uses the left hand to go back to Cunningham. Beautiful ruck work. Figure can't quite get to it. Good work behind again by Northeast. Good tackling by Tom Carr on the chef. And the umpire will come in and throw up.
That was an exciting tackle. He was able to wrap up the one arm and just force his Norwood opponent to the ground.
A ball up. Carter comes down to the chef. He kicks the ball forward. Pascoe clears up on his left leg. He comes back in ball. I think he's kicked his first goal for the afternoon. The crowd are happy behind. The umpire puts up their two fingers. He does. And Nord players run from everywhere to congratulate Pascoe. So Nord move now onto a 14-point margin at the 21.5-minute mark of this second quarter.
Fortunate there from the rebound, but able to make the most of the opportunity. It's a big fellow in Pascoe, but Norwood are doing very well at these 50-50 situations, ball up throw-ins around the ground. The inclusion of Brett James, I think, has been instrumental. Had a lot of quick handballs.
14 points the margin. It's back to the quarter time lead. Cunningham tripped. Seven kicks. Correction. Here's Pascoe's stat, seven kicks. This kid's had 11 and two. Pretty important player in the first half. Cunningham and Bassett marks. What a move it's been. Malloy off, Bassett on. And the big fellow, after being on the field only a couple of minutes, takes a good mark 30 metres out directly in front.
And a vital goal this is.
Carter's coming off. That's bad news for the Magpies. He's in trouble. He can't run at the moment. It looks like something like a, maybe got a knock to the top of the leg in that last clash.
15 games this year for Scotty Bassett, who is in the power squad. And Carter, as we've heard, is feeling the effects. They're 14 points up. This is a very important kick, and he's drilled it. What a good kid he is. Well, some feel the pressure and some just love it. He looks to be pretty relaxed.
It's an exciting young player. Just didn't faze him. Strong mark, eyes only for the football. Went back and just put it right through the middle. And don't you just love that?
See, Stephen Carter doesn't really want to come off, but he can't run that well. So just five kicks and three handballs. Been pretty tough there on a half-back line. Looks like he's going forward. Some clever work again down to Cunningham. Norder charging forward. It's a high ball. Coming out is northeastern front. Ginevar's worked hard to get down there. Nord players thrown to the ground. Players throwing themselves over the football. And Stephen Carter comes off, and we see Hart come back on for his second run for the afternoon. So bad news for the Magpies. Already got Brett Chalmers sitting on the sidelines, now joined by Stephen Carter. A couple of premiership players there. Ball goes out wide. Poulton takes on Tyson. In comes the chef, the clever. Here he goes, Cook. Takes one bounce, takes two. He's inside 50. Kicks it forward. Has he made the distance? I think he has. And it's touched on the last line by Delaney.
It's the small band brigade are really taking control here at the middle part of this second quarter from Norwood. Cook has been exciting. 11 or 12 possessions. Cunningham has just erupted.
Braganza to the running northeast. Northeast punches the ball forward. Magpies have the number, but it's uncontested. We see once again, Pitt takes it. The players running wide and Fleming. He goes to ground. Goes further to Clements. Clements goes wide to Davey. Davey can chip it forward to Cunningham. Decides to go longer with his option. Unfortunately, I think he's kicked it out of bounds on the ball. He has. The ball will be brought back in by Mark Clayton. So Clayton, in front of the coach's box, in front of the member stand, goes down the line. At the back is Ambrose, in the back of Eastall. Umpire will throw it in.
Eastall replaced Matthew Primus, who was taken to Fitzroy and has filled the job beautifully. Just wonder whether, like Primus, he might not get another chance at the AFL as well. He's played pretty well this year. Cunningham, 16 on the bottom of that pack as the crowd warm up. It's a big margin, 21 points in favour of the Redlegs. They sense it, and the Magpie supporters have responded. The atmosphere is unbelievable. We wish you could be here, but for those who can't, we are taking you live through Victoria, South Australia, Western Australia and the Northern Territory through the ABC network. Eastow from behind, wins the tap, thumps it to the back door, but Bond did very well. Dantocchia missed it. Davey had a fumble. Dantocchia comes again for a second opportunity. Sliding in was Ginevar. That was an important one. Tregenza, the handball forward. Balaise just gathers in Clements, and in doing so has given away a free kick. And Clements forces it wide now to Fleming, who has been, Mark, quite outstanding.
But he has been solid. He's had one player taken off him already. His second opponent in Darren Smith. As Norwood comes through the middle of the field, Clayton should cut off. He does. Good lead by West, but well read by Mark Clayton. He goes out wide to Roger Delaney. Delaney will chip the ball forward to Fegan. Fegan will go to the top. He does that to Northeast. Northeast has time. Got Ambrose inside. He decides to go a bit longer. Unfortunately, there's no forwards up there for the Magpies. And again, or once again, we see Lachlan Bowman take an uncontested mark.
It's just a war of attrition. Both defences are clearly on top, but Norwood also a little more dominant in the midfield. So that's the factor. That's the reason why they just head the scoreboard. Weight of numbers.
For the magician, Burgoyne goes wide to Carr. Carr goes out looking for Smith. Smith brings it to ground. Couldn't quite pick that player up.
Pedler has really a role to play today.
some question marks can be resolved for him. Delisted by the Crows, but some people believe he has an important future. He's just got to believe in himself, you'd expect. But he really is a fine athlete. Just needs a little bit of confidence. But the siren has sounded. It's a 20-point ball game in favour of the Redlegs at half-time. King Sheldon that quarter. First half particularly was Port Adelaide's, but the Redlegs responded.
Yes, they weren't able to capitalise when it really mattered about the 15-minute mark, Port, and therefore rebound did the Redlegs, particularly through Fleming. He was magnificent at fullback, as was Pitt and Dan Tocchi, but it was the players such as Cunningham and Harvey, and Big Pasco responded with a goal that really lifted for them. Ginevar was magnificent, as he always is for Port Adelaide, as has Carter been, who now is off the field injured. Also, I think Jared Poulton deserves a mention, as he really has taken Tyson, really quietened him down.
So half-time score here in the grand final. See Norwood, they're 6 goals, 5, 41. Port Adelaide trail, they're 3 goals, 3, 21.
Got your leggies, come on!
Maggie!
McIntosh was robbed.
He didn't hit anybody!
Up the legs, it's our turn this year.
Go Maggie's. Maggie's by 6 goals. Not a problem.
Maggie's by 8.
Tell us why.
Why? They've been in too many grand finals. They don't know how to lose them.
Come on the legs.
So why do you think Norwood are going to win?
Because they're the best.
Because they're the best! We're going to kick Norwood's
Norwood's crap.
Go the Maggies! I really think Norwood are going to win today because it's got a lot more class than them Wharfie blokes. Simple as that. Simple as that.
Magpies. So absolute champions.
Who cares? Crows won last week, we don't care.
Magpies.
He's hoping because he's going to
September time here again.
Should all acquaintance be forgot? Keep your eye on the red and the blue.
But our players keep on fighting, one way to victory!
Go you land! Go you mighty land! Go you!
Well, perhaps some South Australian football fans are feral. And I think if you're sitting in Western Australia or Victoria, you might just think that there are a few loonies down here, and you might well be right. One of the features of Grand Final Day in South Australia this year is the Pilgrims parachute skydiving team. And before the match, they launched in a football park, and we've got a little bit of vision of them coming in now. And that is a frightening thing. Ken, have you ever tried that? And in they come. There's a camera on one of these skydivers. Now, the Pilgrims parachute display team include Mick Honeyman, Jan Honeyman, Tony Smith, Pete Anderson, Steve Renshaw, Steve Jones, Steve Bokey, Shane Strudwick, Cameron Miller, Marcus Prem, and Paul Truman. And both Tony Smith and Steve Jones recently represented Australia in the World Canopy Formation Championships. Now, that's not a bad jump, is it? Now, how would you like to do that? We might put you up for next year, Ken.
Yeah, I'd have a go at that.
Any chance of that?
I think I would. I'm not sure, but I think I would.
Would you? Well, we might set it up now because... I don't know that I'd be all that keen.
Oh, look, it must be exhilarating, no doubt.
Well, Western Bulldogs, Footscray did it, didn't they? Every single player jumped out of an aeroplane. Cornsey walked his players over hot coals.
Team-building exercise. It would be interesting to compare the exhilaration of that to actually winning the premiership here today. I think... Well, I've experienced the premiership wins. I think I might stick with that.
As we go to the half-time scores, it's Port Adelaide 3-3-21. Norwood a 6-5-41. 20 points the margin at half-time.
The goal kickers, David, up to half-time. We see Borlase and Pedler and Ashley for the Magpies got one each. And for Norwood, Dantoshia, Bassett, Eastor, Pascoe and West also one each. So single goal kickers so far in this match.
Statistically, Ken, Port Adelaide... Really matching it in all departments except the handball department.
And that's where the Norwood strength is, with that overlap, that link, and, you know, as I mentioned, their midfielders such as Jarman and such as James, such as Cunningham have been very, very good.
So the second half of the 1997 SANFL Grand Final underway. Your commentator, Mark Naley.
Umpire Kevin Chambers races the football in the air, blows his whistle to start the second half here in the 1997 Grand Final. 20-point margin to the Redlegs over the Magpies. Trent Ray still in ruck up against Keating. Ball comes to ground. Ginevar dives over the football. The free kick has been fouled.
And a significant move by Port Adelaide. Nigel Figgett is lining up at full forward with Ambrose, who was, well, kickless in the first quarter. Now it's in a half-back.
So Borlase goes forward. Out comes Figgett. The player Ken Shilton just spoke about. Been moved from centre-half back now to full forward. Out in front of Fleming.
What you like about this bloke is that he has a great deal of self-belief. He believes that he can match it with anyone out there in the park.
So Nigel Figgett, outside of 50, puts it on his way, kicking into the breeze. Smith's in there, uses his strength to get the ball out. Dantoshi goes wide. Chance here for Port Adelaide. Burgoyne, left leg, snap around his body. Couldn't bring it back far enough, and it's out of bounds on the floor. Now just quickly, fellas, only once in the last 18 grand finals has a team trailing at half-time got up to win, and that was by the Magpies. They were 22 points down in the 1994 grand final against the Eagles. So the Magpies have done it before, but it's only been once in 18 years it has occurred.
Front position, Jarman. Gone. Flicks it out. Matthew Ashley around the corner. A high ball. Now, who wants this one? Great courage required. Borlase's backed in, but it was knocked away from him. Tyson, the winger, pushes it towards half forward in the middle of football park. It rebounds. Carr gets smothered. Great work, Cunningham. Brett James it was. But knee strap, he looks a little like Cunningham. We just wonder, Ken, where Port Adelaide are going to get the lift from.
Obst kicks up forward. The West. There's none better than this player playing a full forward in the SANFL competition than Jimmy West. The Ken Farmless medal with 73 goals after the minor round. He kicked so far, 5 in the finals. This could bring up his 6. Already kicked 1 goal, 1 this afternoon. He's 40 metres out, 35 metres out, directly in front. But no trouble with the distance. He's got the accuracy, and the reflex now extend their margin to 26 points.
And what an important goal that is. The first one after the half-time break. The third quarter, the premiership quarter as it's known throughout the country in Australian rules football. And Norwood it is to extract first blood. To answer your question, David, Port Adelaide need to lift in the midfield. They are trying to shut down the dominance of the Norwood midfielders, but they just can't hold them. Jarman is on top of Borlase. Poulton, whilst he's done a good job in curbing the electric start that James Tyson has had, Tyson was the reason for that goal with his tackle there in midfield, so he's able to do the other things as well. Tregenza is being beaten by Obst. They need some explosion out of the midfield.
Time maybe for Burgoyne or Bond to move into the middle. Get some run through there. Carter, one step and delivers. Loose ball falls. Burgoyne couldn't get there. Bond couldn't get there. Lachlan Bowman can. The red leg centre-half back pushes it towards Stephen Pitt. Left half-back, Dantoccia. They're using the ball pretty well, the Redlegs. That one was pinpoint, but Eastwood, Pascoe at the back, couldn't quite gather it up. And Keating at the front, unable to take the mark.
So I think the efficiency of the Norwood side has been far greater with their use of the ball than Port. Port have wasted opportunities inside 50, particularly in that second quarter when they had dominance in the midfield for a short period.
Jarman. Another change has been made by the Magpies.
Yes, you're right. Ha-Hum has come off for Port Adelaide and having his first run for the afternoon, one of the most experienced players in the Port Adelaide lineup, Rowan Smith.
Stephen Williams trying to make changes. Harvey bursts through the pack. Ambrose, very clever to find Ginevar, who finds Northeast, who finds Warren Treadray. Treadray goes up. Smith behind. In front is Davey. The player, Rowan Smith, who just come on, cleverly across to Vigenza, who goes forward to Bond. Bond around his body, goes up towards Figgett. Figgett will have a jump at this. Out in front, he's taken a sensational grab.
Don't you just love that? The ball was up there to be had, and he just attacked it with everything he had. Launched himself at the footy. Brilliant hands by Rowan Smith.
Nigel Figgett started so well. Stephen Williams needed something up forward, so he's moved Nigel Figgett there. On his way, I think he's kicked it, he has. That's his first of the afternoon. Inspiring mark and aspiring goal. The Magpies now need to lift.
So So after having nothing at full forward for most of the game, Figgett has responded with two great grabs in the opening 5 minutes of this third quarter. Answering the call from his coach, he shifted from centre-half back, opens up with the first goal for the Magpies in this quarter.
Well, that will be an inspired move if it works for Stephen Williams. Figgett has only kicked one goal one for the year prior to today and was dominating centre-half back. Well, don't you just love the way they think at Port Adelaide? They're prepared to take risks and it's working for them so far. Carter dives on top of the ball and Tyson wraps him up. There'll be a bounce. 6 minutes into the third quarter and it's the Redlegs by 20 points.
Rowan Smith off interchange, as we called, is now in the forward pocket. Only needs three or four kicks and will kick three or four goals. A brilliant finisher.
We've seen that type of finish from him previously. Carter pushes through heavy traffic. Guides the ball up towards half-forward right. Darren Smith comes in on Pitt. It's a heavy body, but overrunning it. Back on it is Pitt. He's played well today. To Keating, one step, couldn't get the kick away. Run down by McGuinness. Ashley back to McGuinness in a double play. And look at this, Figgett back there. Good contest. Proclaims Davis on the ball. And out by City. Didn't have the opportunity of getting rid of it. And Mark Nally's not happy.
He's had more than enough time to get rid of that. Todd Davey, that was holdable, got up, looked, great tackle from behind by Nigel Figgett. Balls to ground, Smith.
Oh, give him a rap and he's missed.
No, but that's what he can do, Ken.
Oh, he's a freak around goal and that's just very unlike Rowan Smith, but what a crucial one.
Now, you coached him at St Kilda, where he was pretty dangerous.
Oh, he is, that's what he is, extremely talented player, and opportunities like that, like just money for old rope.
Dan Toshi kicks the ball to himself. Goes to the outer side. Bowman up high. Smith, who's starting to work himself into the game. Quiet in the first half, wasn't he?
Well, he only had four possessions in the first half.
Figgett from behind again. Pitts in front, takes it, plays on quickly. Goes towards centre-half forward. Ambrose from behind up against Pascoe. Ball's taken back to Pascoe. On to James, over the top to the Shep. The Shep will run in. It's there. It's not.
Where do you come up with these nicknames? Sujai Cook, the Shep. All right, we'll go with that. But goodness me. Harms, the Iceman. Nathan Steinbrenner becomes Nathan Steinlager. Now, if you're wondering about the idiosyncrasies, it's Mark Nally, the former Cartman South Adelaide Rover, who I think invents more nicknames for any South Australian footballer than I can remember. As Carr draws the loose man, Northeast runs on, provides some space. Now over the top, it's Carter and Poulton to raffle that one. Carter comes back inside, Davey claims it. What a good tackle that was. So Davey gets run back, the advantage allowed to fly as Jarman bounces away. Two bounces. Look at the precision delivery. It's Cunningham. He takes off the little rover, the best and fairest last year. Look at the kick. It's a ripper. It's found Bassett. 20 out, slight angle.
What a magnificent tackle by number 7, Todd Davey for Norwood. He's turned the ball around for his team and now they have the opportunity to kick a crucial goal in the context of the game. Hit them out to a 26-point lead if battered is successful.
Scott Bassett, who kicked one goal after coming off the interchange bench in the second quarter. They lead by 20 points. The Redlegs, a goal here, 26 ahead, but they're still not done. The Magpies will just keep coming and coming at you. Oh, and it's through. He split the centre. He gets his second, the young man. The Redleg fans like it.
Eastall back on the ground now as Keating leaves the arena. Interchange with the two key ruckmen, Peter Rohde, the coach of Norwood, been instigating that all day. But back to the Todd Davey tackle. Allowed Jarman just to run free with the ball. Perfect use of the football. And what about this provision by Cunningham? Could have had a ping, but then elected to pick out Bassett, who had created space. Thank you, Todd Davey, the Norwood supporters will be saying.
9 minutes, nearly 10-minute mark of this third quarter. 26-point margin. Now to the Redlegs. Good hands by Jagenza to find Borlase. Borlase goes up. At the back of McGuinness, gets one hand up. Davies there. McGuinness gets it, takes it onto his boot. Which way does ball bounce? It sits up for Smith. He needs support. Goes back to Figgett. Figgett goes back to Borlase. Borlase under extreme pressure. Goes forward. can only register another behind for the Magpies.
Aaron Keating in the bunker, a player who tells me that he didn't have one drink after Sunday night celebrating the Crows' great grand final victory in Melbourne. What extreme discipline that was. D'Antocchia kicks it to himself, provides another 5 metres on the kick, and Darren Smith at the back just reads it beautifully, chips it in top. Davey's been important this quarter. Great tacklers, Ken Shelton told you just moments ago. Now, clever pickup, but Carter, too big and too strong for Roger James. Marks and steadies. A short one. They need more from Troy Bond, and he provides the pass to McGuinness. McGuinness is too far out to score, drills it in. Oh, look at this! Danger signs as Rowan Smith marks 45 metres out.
So Wynn will take this ball slightly left to right. Rowan Smith will get back in from here without a doubt.
Well, he's a goal kicker, but only two this year. He's played in six premierships since 88. And as you've already heard, he spent 1991 with Ken Sheldon at St Kilda. Oh! 2 points with two kicks, and when two goals would have been pivotal.
Yes, we don't want to harp on it, but certainly if he could have them over again, he would put them through. But not to be, and Norwood now have the opportunity to turn a miss into a two-goal turnaround.
Hit just taken by Ashley. The ball goes out wide. Tyson comes across. Dives across the line, but keeps the mark inside. He goes further afield, trying to find Cunningham. Will he keep it in? No, he's quite prepared to see it out over the line. So the ball within the forward half for the Redlegs. Big Pasco up against Warren Treadray. Ambrose drops back for the quick kick out. Pasco in front, too strong for Treadray. Bond snares it, takes it. Good smother by again by Tyson. Some good work being done, and again, looks like some changes have been made down there, Rob Popplestone.
Have indeed. Nails coming off will be Roger James for his first spell this afternoon, and Malloy will go back to a forward position.
Just going back to that Tyson smother, like he laid the tackle, which seen the Bassett goal, and that smother might create another one for them.
Carr upended Harvey, Bassett stolen away, stripped away by Pedler. Quick hands was good to Ginevar, to Tregenza in traffic. Got the kick away, he did pretty well, didn't he? Pin over the top of it, but now Sujai Cook, the chef as Mark Naley has named him, goes long with a bomb towards full ball. Oh, West! Oh, James, you ripper!
Well, that's just an incredible grab.
Put the saddle on Ambrose, stitched him around the girth, went for the Spurs and took the big ride. Oh, Jimmy!
Come on, down, Jim West.
Well, you won't see many better grand final marks than that. And if he kicks the goal, the roof will come off this stadium. What a recruit he's been. Oh, he's kicked it. He's got it. James gets his third after a mega mark.
And more importantly, he's second in this third quarter, which has put Norwood now out to a 30-point lead. Often you see when a great grab's like taken like that, the player goes back and misses the simplest of goals. So full credit to Jim West, who was able to complete both tasks.
Oh. What an opening.
Oh, get your blood flowing, that does. Gets your adrenaline pumping. We see Deck down to Cook. Cook quickly forward to 30-point margin here to the Redlegs. Good mark taken by Carr.
And my recollection, Mark, is that the Magpies were 22 points down in the second semi-final and won by 22, so the game's not over yet.
Yeah, 17 points down there through the third quarter, won by 22.
I think most importantly, though, that probably the most influential player that Port Adelaide have was off the ground in Chalmers.
McGuinness round his body, snaps it forward, will figure it, Margaret. What will he do? He can't quite get his foot to it.
The luck just not going the way of the Magpies. They've had their opportunities, but just haven't been able to get them through for major scores. As we mentioned, Brett Chalmers, their number one ruckman and an outstanding player in their comeback in the second semi, has been off the ground since midway through the first quarter.
Fleming, whose first quarter was inspirational. In fact, his first half was incredible. Six kicks, five handballs and seven marks. I don't think quite tells the story. It's been very strong. Pitt run down by Bond. Bond's pace important there. To half forward, oh, Harvey clever to Eastor. The big ruckman is running, and that's ominous for the Magpies. Pushing and shoving in the goal square is Paul Cunningham. He's good at this. He's very good at this. Oh, hasn't he kicked some important goals in the finals, this young fella? That's his first, but his finishing in the finals has been fantastic.
He's playing an outstanding Rovers game. Brilliant quick heart hands by Harvey to Eastor. The long kick in, look at that, where good Rovers should be, to the front and square of the pack, able to snare upon the loose ball, thrummed it brilliantly, and then finished with, well, an excellent left foot snap. Look at that, just dropped it across his body. Brilliant skills.
Now they might just find a spot for him in Geelong again. They delisted him, but I think they might want him back now.
Again, Tredray, Nord working overtime at the moment to get the ball forward. That kick came out by Jarman. A foot race between Obst and also Trigger Tregenza. Back to Ambrose, who's moved back in this third quarter. Good work again by Harvey.
Just talking about that, David, we talked about football being, like, it really is where how you bounce back. Now, this kid Cunningham was outstanding last year. He won the best and first. He wrecked his knee in the opening minutes of this season. He's bounced back now. He really struggled in the second semi, the lack of fitness, but he's again continued to work and made the most of it. Like, full credit to him.
Oh, thank you. Big body clash there between Tregenza. It looked like Tyson or Obst. It was Davey from half-back flank.
It was Davey, and Davey comes in strong, bang. Oh, and they're both down. Now, Todd Davey knocked himself out in two finals last year and didn't play the sort of footy that he's capable of, and he might have done it to himself again today. Meanwhile, Jarman back with the ball at full forward. They're calling for the stretcher, and Bassett gets away the handball. Harvey held up in play, and Davey is wobbly on his feet, and Tregenza looks a mess.
Well, they can't stop the play until a free kick or out of bounds. Now it will stop, and the stretches will come on now. So the play will stop here for a good while.
Now, you've got to give due credit. Tregenza saw it coming. Oh, and that is sickening. They clashed heads, obviously. Davey was coming hard. Tregenza, give him his due. It's a grand final. He didn't deviate off the line. That is one of the great acts of courage.
They've only got one actual stretcher here. They've got to bring out the stretcher mobile.
Now, this watch this stretcher mobile come out. Now, this is where this thing can make an impact. You've got two players down. They should have a couple of these here. These are important. Now, I don't know why they don't have these at every AFL game. The AFL are dragging their heels on this one. And Ian Collins, if you're listening, this is an important one. It's about the players. Now, they won't let this on the MCG. They won't let it into Victorian grounds. But have a look how quickly that's got out there. They'll get one player off quickly. They can come back for the other. They should have two at every ground, in my view.
Well, they do at AFL games, Dave. They have normally one in the northern goals and one in the southern goal mouth.
Yeah, but look at the horse flesh that's out there on the football field these days. We've got to be worried about the players' welfare. Get them off, get them treated quickly. That's probably one of the best innovations in modern football. And Davey,
he's up. He's awake. Gee, a bit groggy. Doesn't want to get on the stretcher. He's pushing the trainers there away. But nothing spiteful in that clash.
No,
just two bodies hitting each other at full pace.
Great courage.
Both players having eyes for the football only.
I think the fans will give both players a standing ovation. They deserve it. We come along, we pay our money, but when you don't have times of war, this is the next best show of courage you can find. Bang. Shoulder was down. They just simply clashed heads, I think.
We might go down to Rob Popplestone. Some changes have been made. Which players will come on?
The boundary, down here on the boundary, Mark Malley. I can tell you that Harm has come on for Simon Tregenza, who's now coming off on the stretcher by way of six trainers. And while Todd Davey makes his way off on the ambulance stretcher, he doesn't want to come off, but Stephen Rowe has come on for his first run this afternoon and got a great response from the members stand here.
You've got to feel for Todd Davey, who knocked himself out in two finals last year and has done it again today.
Well, such is
the will to win. Like, you hype yourself up for these games, you cop a head collision like this, you are knocked out. When you regain consciousness, that's all you want to do in your brain is to get back out there and compete again. But obviously medical staff will prohibit that from happening.
Well, I think that little scooter is the best thing that's happened to injured players. I mean, it's just sad to see four trainers carrying a bloke off. And they get him. Now, perhaps they should. The innovation needs to be the stretcher needs to sit on top. They can pick him straight up off the stretcher and take him into the rooms. I wouldn't agree with this. I reckon put him on a stretcher and keep him going. I think that's the only other adjustment. They need to put a stretcher on top of that so they can just wheel the player straight up, pick him up off the boundary line and straight into the race.
We're back with the play. Umpire just waiting. The ball will be thrown in. He puts his hand in the air once again. We see Big Pascoe and Ambrose will contest the ball in. Coming in late was Treadray. Couldn't quite time it. Jarman takes it, kicks it forward. Again, Carter plays on. The umpire's called it. Holding the ball, umpire. He's played on. The support's there. Cunningham! Yeah. Cunningham! Johnny Cunningham. It's his second goal for the quarter. 16 kicks so far in the game and really has come back to fine form.
Looming
is grand final day.
Looming is one of the best, Ed.
Oh, no doubt. And just Carter there, indecisive, in two minds, and was forced to the ground by Malloy. Cunningham just there to mop it up.
Well, his father, we mentioned, played in the 61 Premiership for Hawthorn. Just trying to think, I think he does qualify for Hawthorn under the father and son. Might be an easy pickup for them.
That's right, he certainly put himself on the map here today with an excellent performance as the first rover for his side. He's winning the grand final at this stage and he's clearly in the best players on the ground.
Well, the Cook take it high. Umpire calls play on Northeast. Chips the ball up towards Ambrose. Ambrose plays it on and needs something. What can Ginevar do? Goes over the top to Ashley. Ashley down the grandstand wing, kicks it high. Eastall's there, should take the mark, and does, uncontested. It really has been the call of the day, is really the Magpies going forward haven't hit a target.
Eastall with the kick, 2-1. Pascoe did pretty well. Loose ball falls down. Look at this, Cunningham is in the thick of everything at the moment. He is igniting them. James West at full forward, double team. Cook, the crummer, around the corner, tries to bend it back. It was a pretty fair effort, wasn't it? Fair effort, it hit the post. Oh, there were a few Norwood fans thought like hiding. It just kept turning. And he's hit the post.
See here, the front of the pack again, the Norwood Rovers. Cook in this instance. He just hooked that ball around. It kept bending, but not quite far enough.
From half-back, ball A's to half-forward. Darren Smith's had a remarkably quiet day. Unlike him, he normally plays beautifully in big games. There's a... Three kicks, four handballs. A free kick, no. Boys will be boys. Rowan Smith antagonising Lachlan Bowman. Lockie thinks he's got a free kick. Sapphire Bettridge puts the big fellows at it again. We're 23 and a half minutes into the third quarter. It's a 42-point ball game in favour of the Redlegs. They haven't got it won yet, but they're certainly in control. And things will start to tighten up from here.
Clearly, Port Adelaide have beaten them in the centre bounces to my way and around the ground at the packs in that situation. But inside 50, when they're coming into their full forward line, Port Adelaide have been very, very poor, whereas Norwood have been able to make the most of it.
Harvey's ball's up to Treadray, couldn't take it. Ambrose there, keeping his feet, was Eastor. Northeast for the Maggies in there, gives a quick handball across it. Barnes played to Carter. Carter's walked into a wall. The umpire realised the mistake was made. There was no advantage for the Port Adelaide side. It will come back.
That's common sense umpiring.
Good umpiring.
Just back to that point that I made, David. Inside 50, Port Adelaide are not hitting a target. And at the rebound, Norwood are overlapping with a chain of handballs and really getting some run going. And that's where the difference is. Their midfielders, it's just given him the edge.
No doubt about that, Ginevar in the midfield. Now they're playing their Port Adelaide style. They flick it wide and then run it. That's what they've done this time. Carr drills it in long to Fleming, who's been stellar in the defensive zone. Just rubbers one across the line.
Here's another opportunity. Like, had the ball coming down the outer flank, could have pumped it inside 50, hit a target, but nowhere to be found. Full credit to Fleming playing in front, but you've got to be able to hit the target when you're the ball carrier.
Some great stories. Fleming, one of them, not required by Fitzroy. Well... and shattered a cheekbone last year. Sickening blow to the head, but he's come back this year and played his best football and will play in a premiership side, it would appear. We might be a bit early in saying that. as Port Adelaide have come back from here many times.
Well, Norwood David have finished third the last two seasons. They've been knocked out for their grand final appearance. Today they've got their chance to win their first since 1984. As Port Adelaide go forward again, comes to ground, Bowman just needs to take control. He can't quite get there. He's got control, but still, Smith holds his arms in the air, looking for the free kick. James, Tyson, and go forward. He does. Finds Pitt. Pitt's got time and the luxury to take a bounce and go again if he wishes. He doesn't. He goes forward. Contest between Pedler. Roger Daniels is there. And the ball's out over the line. The 1997 Grand Final can be purchased from the football video number you saw there. That's an Adelaide number. So any interstate people that are watching today's game from either WA, Northern Territory, Victoria, even Southern New South Wales, just ring that number, 08 8343 4610, to purchase your copy of this 1997 Grand Final. All gone up. Great courage shown by Cunningham, running with the flow of the football. So Cunningham, outside of 50, will put to the top of the square. That's the team's discipline. It falls short. Good spot behind by Roger Delaney.
Roger Delaney, who's played in six premierships. And Andrew Jarman, the only one, I think, that's played in one. The 87 Grand Final with North Adelaide. Cunningham, very clever. Spins away. West makes a contest. Carded very well. Punched it down, but only as far as Harvey. He bends it back around the corner. The crowd like it. Harvey likes it. Oh, they've gone to 48 points ahead. Stepping away, the Redlegs. That's Harvey's second.
The captain of the Norwood side for the day. A vice captain under normal circumstances. Gary McIntosh suspended in the preliminary final last week. And what a great captain's goal that has been.
The Rednecks really are playing their heart out for their captain, who's not out there. Suspended during the week for one game for striking last week. We see the score there now. 31 plays, 80. It's a match-winning lead so far. And a 27, nearly 28-minute mark of this third quarter. Northeast been solid in defence. Comes wide to Clayton. The bounce will favour Ops. Obbs is thrown to the ground by Clayton, who didn't have the ball. Obbs will receive the free kick. The umpire's not playing the advantage. We'll come back to Obbs. So Obbs, just outside the 50 metres. He's going to lead from West. The kick needs to be good. Couldn't quite carry. West needs the support. He's found it. Cook goes over the top of Rose's head. Carter will break the packs. He doesn't. He just keeps going towards the boundary line. Puts it out in front of Borlase. Borlase should pick it up. He does. Which way will he go? He's got nowhere to turn. Under extreme pressure, Jarman, the magic of Jarman, finds a target in Clements.
Well, this lead really has been set up by the tremendous defence. Fleming, Dantocchia with a goal. Pitt, now Clements off the half-back, has been tremendous. And it's their midfield, such as Harvey, Brett James, Tyson, Obst, Jarman, as you mentioned, and probably none better than Cunningham.
Clements outside 50, puts the ball high in the air. Will the breeze take it? I think it has. It's got there. It's home. For Clements, it's his first goal for the afternoon. And really, this has been the Rednecks' quarter, their grand final quarter.
Bowman also been tremendous at centre half back, but that goal from Clements there, that's the second from defence that the Redlegs have been able to manufacture today. So some strong running from defence, some tremendous foot disposal in the midfield. They've kicked goals, Cunningham, Harvey, those type of players, and of course West, the only key forward on the who's functioning on the field.
55 points the margin in favour of the Redlegs. Well, you need to be Port Adelaide mad to believe they could get back from here. As Carter pushes it to forward, Pitt, oh, courage. Running with the flight of the ball, he kept his eyes on the ball, and he knew that Feagert was looming around the goal square like a rhinoceros. Pitt East or front position and the boundary line.
44,000, David, 161 patrons have witnessed this classic traditional grand final played against some of the oldest clubs here in South Australia, the Magpies, Port Adelaide Magpies and the Norwood Redlegs. Ball's coming back in, taken by Rohde. Rohde will come back and actually take the kick. So Rohde, who just came on this third quarter when Todd Davey went down, that heavy clash with Simon Tregenza. The ball's punched forward. Cunningham, who's been everywhere, had a sensational third quarter. Out to Eastall. Malloy, back to Rohde. Rohde, quick hands to Jarman. Jarman under Pasco. Pasco up forward. Good spoil by Pedler. The Cook around the body, up towards West, one-on-one, Weston Delaney. The ball's loose, Burgoyne's been moved back. He's got no support out wide. He has down the middle of the ground, and that's which way he does come. He finds his captain in Ginevar.
As we go down to Rob Popplestone on the boundary.
Thanks, DB. In a few moments' time, I think you'll see the umpire will pick up blood streaming out of Malloy from Norwood's left side of his face. Still, he'll have to leave the ground and get stitched up. And I can tell you that the gash to Todd Davey, who left on a stretcher earlier, is very, very bad. Probably requires somewhere in the vicinity of 20 stitches, they've suggested.
Thanks, Rob. Now, the breeze, Rob, while you're there, how strong is it?
It's still actually probably not as strong as it was in the first half, DB, but still favouring the left of screen quite significantly.
Comments, Rob Popplestone, former Sturt and Eagle player, as Eastall wins the tap. It falls down, Rohde misses it. Bond, who's been surprisingly quiet. It's not that he hasn't had the possessions, he just hasn't had the impact. Nine kicks. Yeah. Short of the sets, and there's Malloy with that eye cut. Got to use a bit of initiative, I think, and get a trainer out to at least wipe it down. Or get off yourself.
Exactly.
Obst. Esau. Around the corner, the big fellow's doing pretty well. Malloy misses it. Carr, who has had a lot of work to do in defence for Port Adelaide, pushes another one out. Rowan Smith couldn't quite take it. Pitt just harasses him. Now James feeds it forward. Now there's some run. Tyson off to Pitt. Oh, well done, Rowan Smith. Run him down. Great tackle. And you won't see better than that, Mark.
Well, good work by Smith. Maybe not too much voice in support for Pitt. The 25-metre again being played against Matthew Ashley. Lachlan Bowman, the centre-half back for the Redlegs, will take it. So Bowman puts it on its way up forward. Pasco, bit of strength, good spoil from behind. The ball's out of bounds.
Had a very good crowd, 44,161. As Mark Nardi told you earlier, enjoying this encounter. Another traditional clash. They've been great opponents over the years. Ginevar working hard off to northeast. His first quarter was unbelievable. A high ball and the siren sounds. So it's three-quarter time in the 97 grand final and 55 points the margin in favour of the Redlegs, Ken. And you've got to ask the question, can Port Adelaide, even the great Port Adelaide, come back from here?
I think the answer is clearly no to that question, but what a performance from the Norwood midfield in that quarter. Their defence has been tremendous all day. Players such as Pitt, Fleming, Dantocchia and Clements, who goaled in that third quarter, have been absolutely fantastic. But the midfield, Jarman, now these type of players, Cunningham, young Cook, Harvey, were just fantastic. They really did respond. And their key forward, the Ken Farmer medalist in Jim West, responded with the mark of the grand final, no doubt, and two excellent goals in that third quarter.
We see there Coach Stephen Williams still in his coach's box, yet to leave. On the other hand, Coach Peter Rohde was first out. He sprinted out to the pack. But three-quarter time, we see Gary McIntosh, the unfortunate captain who couldn't be out there. So three-quarter time score here in the grand final. Port Adelaide, they're 4-7-31. They trail Norwood in that fantastic third quarter. They're 13-8-86. And you're watching the SANFL grand final exclusive to ABC Sport.
Yeah.
Welcome back. 55 points, Ken. Quite an incredible third quarter by the Redlegs, wasn't it?
Magnificent performance. Port Adelaide now have to kick 10. They have the breeze at their back. They really haven't had a key forward all day, and they are being, I think, clearly shown a clean pair of heels by the Norwood midfield.
Well, there's a fair amount of pressure on the women folk who support their players in the grand finals. We go down to Rob Popplestone on the boundary with one of them.
Thanks for that, DB. Yes, the wife of Darryl Borlase, vice-captain of the Port Adelaide side. And Jenny, you've just returned from Canberra for the Nationals this morning.
Yes, I had a quick trip back here, hoping probably to see a bit of a better result. But no, there's still got a quarter to go. You never know what can happen.
Now, you've been known Darryl for a long time, and we know all know Port Adelaide, they won't give up, no matter how far they be up.
I think they just need to find someone a bit more dominant in the forward lines, and they've got a good chance. So it's going to be a good last quarter, but Norwood are playing particularly well and have had a great season.
Now, I caught up with Darryl earlier in the year, and obviously with your commitments to the Australian netball, he said that he's had to learn to cook. Is that actually the truth or not?
He's a very good cook, and just as well, otherwise he'd probably starve. So no, we do have to share a lot of the duties at home because we are both playing our sport and takes up a lot of our time.
What about the week this week, Darryl? As we mentioned, been a part of a successful Port Adelaide decade, and obviously he'd be excited about his prospects this year. And what about beyond this year?
Yeah, I think, you know, he's taking it year by year at this stage and was hoping for a really big game today. Was quite nervous last weekend, but was calm during the week. So, you know, still got a while to go, and I think that he'll reassess his career at the end of this game.
And as a real Darryl, on grand final morning, what's he like? Because he's had a few grand final mornings in his career.
He normally gets a little bit nervy and likes to push and shove me around the house a bit. We normally have a bit of a kick and a catch before he comes to the game. So he's normally quite cool and calm, and grand final day's not much different.
Thanks for that, Jenny. Good luck with netball, of course, this year. Yes. And a kick and a catch and probably a cuddle on grand final morning, DV.
Not so much of that, I don't think, Rob, but not a bad warm-up partner, Ken. A bit like a tennis player, just having someone to hit to. He's got a wife who can kick and catch with him. So it's three-quarter time in the 1997 SANFL Grand Final. It's Norwood 13-8, leading Port Adelaide 4-7, the margin 55 points.
And fellas, the goal kickers up to three-quarter time. We see for the Magpies, Figgett, Pedler, Borlase and Ashley still one for Norwood. West with three goals, Bassett with two, Harvey with two, Cunningham with two, and Dan Toshier from a back pocket brought up his single in the first quarter.
And you can see the stats coming up here. Kicks very even, but the handballs is where Norwood have got away. And inside 50, Port Adelaide's efficiency is not there. The rebound tremendous for Norwood, and that's why they're ahead on the scoreboard.
Nobody has ever kicked 10 goals in the final quarter of a grand final. Now we'll need to see them at their best of Magpies if they're to win. It's a 55-point ball game in favour of the Redlegs as we go into the final quarter of the 97 grand final. Harvey flicks it across the top. It's Tyson streaming through half forward. Their confidence is high, the Redlegs. The kick is a wobbler. Delaney tries to get through, but Malloy gets him, and Rowe came crashing through. It's caused an injury to his teammate. But look at this shot for goal. It's a point from Pascoe.
Pascoe, possibly one of the tallest men on the ground. A pretty big impact since coming off interchange midway through the second quarter.
Third ray, so a slight fumble taken by Obst. Force the ball out over the line. Just the nose possession today has been Timmy Ginevar, which may surprise a few, hasn't really been that noticeable. Done a lot of hard work in the packs. He's had 28 possessions. Next best in the ground is Cunningham, who's been sensational with 21 possessions.
Jarman putting that full ball forward for Norwood. Borlase in the forward pocket now for Port. And Burgoyne finds himself on the McGarry medalist.
Good kick forward. Jarman takes it. Cunningham again handballs across to Malloy. Malloy was ready to give it off before he took it. And is taken to the ground by Carr in northeast.
I thought that Borlase had really worked himself back into the game. I thought his third quarter was pretty effective on Andrew Jarman.
If you're not at home, that's the next best way of watching the game. Close up. Borlase has 12 kicks, one handball. Jarman is 11 kicks, 10 handballs. Jars make that 12 handballs as he flicks that one back. Now Carter tries to crash through. Malloy got him. Jarman ricochets one off Ginevar. Ambrose couldn't control the ball. Now it's aerial ping pong. It's Jars again, but Ambrose has got him. Wraps him up beautifully. Forces the bounce.
There's been a lot of that by both teams here today, which you truly expect in any big game. But the tackles and the smothers have been the first rate.
So we're 2.5 minutes into the final quarter. Special comments, Ken Shelton. On the boundary line, it's Rob Popplestone. And Mark Naley with us also, the former Carlton and South Adelaide star. Oh, look at this, Malloy. 40 out, has West short. But Delaney did very well to guard the mark. And this is, I think, the first possession for Malloy, Ken. Is that, that couldn't be right, surely. It is. Well, he'll want to kick this. Four goals in the second semi, 39 for the year. Spent, what, 4 years or so with Melbourne, and boom, right through the middle. He'll still enjoy that. Every kick's important.
Might be his first possession, but he has been, I guess, a decoy for West, particularly in the third quarter. He's also laid a couple of very good tackles. And this one here, he just backed himself in. He's a prodigious kick of the footy, very accurate, kicking into the teeth of the breeze there. But he was confident all the way that he could make the distance. First blood in the last quarter, as it was in the third, for the Redlegs.
93 plays 31. 3.5 minute mark in this last quarter. First blood in the last quarter here to the Redlegs. Ambrose goes forward into Figgett. Figgett outside 50, goes for the goals. Strays across the face and out of bounds on the field. A fair bit of breeze there. He was well outside 50. The ball carried over the line. So again, Norwood to bring it back in. Ball's kicked high. Figured again. The player just kicked that. Covered some ground. Taking the mark. He needs to get in quickly. Get Smith one-on-one. He goes that way. Going back is Bowman. Bowman misses the Tregent. Not Tregent, it was Ashley. Both with that dark flowing hair. Both about the same size. We see James clears it.
Brett James, who had 3 years with Collingwood. Back now, and it wins a flag with the Crows. And will win another flag with the Redlegs today. I think you'll like this week. There might be a few headaches in store for him. And look at number three for Port Adelaide. He's opposite number. Troy Bond. He won't be celebrating all that much this week, Troy. And he couldn't really celebrate last week. But I think Brett's in for a few headaches. And so too is this fellow, Aaron Keating, number 18 in ruck, as he also played in the Crows Premiership. So they've got two premierships, these fellas, in 8 days. Hobbs, the speedster, just had a fumble. Can he recover it? Forced it forward. Fegan, look at the big fellow. He did pretty well with pace. Almost ran Hobbs down. Now the high ball. It's Weston Delaney, and West couldn't quite get there. Delaney flicks it out. Cunningham needs support, doesn't get it. Malloy just paddles it forward. Now Hans, one step and bang. Drives it forward, the umpire had to duck, and Borlase comes hard. Harvey comes harder, and Carr right over the top, steamroller both of them.
It was interesting when a Treadray was clearly in position to mark that ball, but ran straight into the umpire. Just one of those things that happened.
Sorry, Kim, that is a very sad story. Brett Chalmers, not selected for the Crows, really wanted to do well for Port Power, went off in the first quarter with a knee injury. That is a sad grand final story.
Best on the ground in the second semi-final, and clearly the most influential player that Port have.
Carter comes up with the football, across the Carr. Carr goes to the goal square, going back. We'll end up with Bowman. Bowman's got numbers out, he's got players everywhere. Take your pick, he goes to the Bowman, it ends up with it from Pitt, sorry to say. So Bowman goes down the line. Ball bounce. Rohde comes in solid, got support there by Keating. Keating takes it. The players on the lead, looks for one of them over the top. Comes down to Northeast. Northeast got support there with Bomb. He uses the handball over the top. Bomb now will run. Takes one bounce, two bounces, three bounces. Will go again. Four bounces, five bounces. Now drives it out forward. At the back, Pedler. Good use of the body. Good use of the hands.
Now the risks that Port have to take. Borlase now back in the midfield on Jarman. And goals like this have to be kicked.
62-point margin. I think that 61-point margin with a thump there from the defence, led by Lachlan Bowman. Really, Ken, has played a sensational game this afternoon. Held down that defence. Really has been strong and solid all afternoon.
Yes, he really has settled in brilliantly, the centre-half back, over a number of years now, and just really nothing flamboyant about him, yeah. But just does his job week in, week out.
13 kicks and a handball. for him, and he certainly shut Darren Smith out of the contest.
Which is no mean feat, because Darren Smith is a proven finals performer, big game performer.
Yes, he is. No doubt about that. Keating, who's building a reputation of his own. A grand final last week in... the week before... well, last week in Melbourne. How are we going for time? And this week another one. Ginevar, northeast. A hurried kick forward. Burgoyne, well, we've hardly sighted him today. Chips it in towards D. Smith. And Pitt takes front position and feeds it off, but Darren Smith recovers. Handballs it back to McGuinness. McGuinness steadies one step and bangs it in long. Pedler got it just inside the line. He already has one. Pedler, he can go back and play on if he wants to. But I think he might opt for a banana kick.
Just like to point out how difficult a mark like that is to take. The goalpost, they don't shift. And he's really running flat out at that. It's just good courage.
And he's going to go on the left. He's kicked a few. And he's got it. That's his second. 2-1 for Pedler today. They need more from their key forwards. Ambrose has let them down. Darren Smith's been well held. But Pedler chips in with a couple.
With the respect to those forwards, though, the way that the ball is coming inside 50 is it's been abysmal for Port Adelaide today. Perhaps that's a reflection of the great pressure that Norwood have been able to put on both ways in the midfield. I can remember clearly a great tackle and a smother by James Tyson, the chasers of Obst. They really have been working both ways, the Norwood midfielders.
Keating. Hand the ball once again. Rowe, head down, tail up. Tucks the ball under his arm.
Reckon Rowe, you'll go on. Mark?
Well, Stephen Rowe, only age 31.
Got 5 years left.
Maybe not quite five, but definitely can contribute for another couple of seasons. He's playing good football early in the season, and just prior to the minor round finishing, got that serious ankle injury.
And this fellow's improved out of sight too. They did pretty well, didn't they, picking up Esau and Keating virtually at the same time. The Magpies, and they lost Primus.
Northeast has been one of the better players for the Magpies this afternoon. There's another mark at 17 kicks. As Northeast is a turnover once again, Cunningham kicks up forward. West, the big arm up against Delaney. Leader player taking the mark. The ball once again rushed over the line to bring up another behind.
The Norwood have only won 7 flags since 1945. They've won 26 overall, but the last 13 years have been barren since 1984. They have been a powerful club without winning the big one. Poulton steps away, spears it forward, and look at this, Jerry Dantocchia. What a stature he's got at the Redlegs. Not quite as high as Gary McIntosh, but not far off. Obst, who played with Sturt when they struggled to win a game and has found himself at a new club, new environment, playing wonderful football, and now ends up with a flag. It's Ambrose, the former Sydney Swan player. Spent most of the year in the reserves this year, but came back to play a vital part in the second semi-final. Borlase handballs to space. Keating crashes through. Oh, go big man. Harvey handballs it back again to the ruckman. He did that earlier and he got caught. Well, it nearly worked, didn't it? Cunningham misses. I thought he was going to do something extraordinary. He's already kicked 2-1. He did get a couple in the second semi-final and a couple in the preliminary. As we go down to Rob Popplestone.
Thanks, DB. A few changes for the Red Legs at the moment. Malloy coming back off the ground with that stitches over his left eye opening up again. Roger Jones coming back on. And just as we speak, coming onto the ground will be Simon Eastor. And leaving again is Aaron Keating.
Good mark. For some class.
Yeah, good mark by Jarman. Terrific grab. I reckon he'll back himself here.
Goal kicking runs in the family, doesn't it, fellas? Although Jars this year hasn't been all that accurate. 5 goals, 14 for the year.
Realised he couldn't make the distance. Aims for the top of the square. Ambrose puts his arms up and takes a good mark. Goes wider. Ginevar. This too could be his last game of SANFL football. been rumoured this week, ending up to four or five Port Adelaide players. We've all already known two today have given it away. In Mark Tyler.
As we go down to Rob Popplestone
and George Fiarchi.
Well, just as we speak about players maybe playing their last game, Rowan Smith comes on probably for his last game at senior level for the Port Adelaide side, and Hahn comes off.
Gee, there'll be some vacancies. A few of those youngsters out there watching, just get the pre-season, fellas.
I don't think they'll let them all retire at once, believe me. Four only to have a way of getting going on. There's a free kick picked out here. It's a Port Adelaide free kick, and it's going to Clayton. Bassett got him too high, said the umpire. 13 minutes into the final quarter. I think the Redlegs can start to pop the champagne, I reckon. It's a 57-point margin. Esau from behind claims the mark. The umpire agrees with him. It's been very good. 8 kicks, 5 handballs, 5 marks and 10 hitouts today. Oh, Pasco almost set it up for a ripper, but couldn't quite bring it down. And Malloy is injured and goes down. We might get Rob Popplestone to check on Malloy for us. And Pasco takes a big fly.
The ball thrown in. Pasco back to Cunningham. Cunningham inside 50. Pushes it across the face of the goal. And beats it another behind. He's kicked two goals, four to this afternoon. It really has been damaging. We see Clayton there nearly miss a mark. Had time to be able to control it. Smith, the game really has slowed down now, realising that the margin may be too great for the Magpies to peg back. The 14-minute mark of this last quarter. Lord in charge, here's Rowe, front of the pack. He's got a player in there, he'll use him, finds him, it's Harvey. Harvey plays on, Harvey goals. Lord have won the 1997 Grand Final.
Peter Rohde, you can see the joy on his face.
Okay, I just heard a few pops. The champagne bottles have gone, and a few tops have gone.
Stephen Rohde, beautiful disposal. In this instance, picked out Harvey, who ran hard to the front of the square and kicked.
Brett Clavey there, and Peter Rohde. I think they know they're home. 102 plays 38.
The Norwood supporters are waving the Magpie Army as they leave Football Park.
And I suppose that they're only repaying a few. Peddler. Well, Port Adelaide fans have been tremendous fans, haven't they? They've supported right to the death, and it's very rare to see Port Adelaide fans leave. Don't worry about that. They are one club that don't leave before the siren. So I'm surprised that a few are turning away. As Darren Smith marks, 30 out, 45-degree angle, and with no goals, no points against his name, he's put that one through. You just know that it's too late. But we've got to just say he's been a great champion. I think he'll go on too, by the way, so I don't think there's any thought of him retiring. He can really make an impact over the next two or three seasons.
An excellent mark here, very difficult to do. Good body pressure by Fleming, who's also played very, very well for Norwood, along with his five other defenders. That back line has been tremendous.
Ball's down, centre square. Cook comes through, 102 plays 44. Cook, the chef, still got it. Goes back to Hobbs. Hobbs around his body. Harvey got the support, got the runners. Big Pasco lumbers through the midfield. Kicks it high, one-on-one. Comes to ground, Smith. That's Rowan Smith for the Maggies. Comes out, finds Ginevar, who's been everywhere this afternoon. Tried hard. Had 21 kicks, 10 handballs, 31 possessions, 7
look at
marks.
This. Look at this.
It's come back in again. Rowe from behind!
Won't he love that, Rowe?
Well,
look at that.
Look at the smile.
When he retells that tonight, it'll be three stories high. He actually took that one on top of the goalpost. That one sat on top of the goalpost and brought it down. Well, that's so the legend goes. And Peter Rohde liked that one too. Good on you, Rohde. Then Rosser behind, and Gary McIntosh looks on happily, but I'm sure he's a shattered man missing this spectacular moment.
Stephen Rowe maybe a little bit too close. The umpire just warning him.
Now, he wouldn't be hugging the limelight,
no,
would he?
He wouldn't.
Not much. Radio personality, raconteur, and goal kicker.
Rowe. It's only his sixth kick for the afternoon. It's his first goal, but look at the players. They appreciate the work that he's done this year. He's got them to where they are. Sensational start to the season, Ken Sheldon, by Stephen Rowe. And he's excited, man.
It's a big grab. The uncharacteristic disposal out of defence by Port Adelaide. The disposal has really let them down. Perhaps it's partly, well, lack of skill, but also I think a lot has to be paid tribute to the just the pressure that Norwood have been able to place upon them.
For those of you who don't know, Stephen Rowe is on a radio show Sundays called The Big Roast, and he is one of the great characters of football. As Sujai Cook goes to half forward, Rowe tries to take a one-hander. Harvey with pace, he gets through traffic. Clayton claimed him and cleaned him up pretty well. West almost marks. James snaps the goal, it's around the corner. Roger James gets his first. The Redlegs will be celebrating tonight.
So they really have responded in the midfield. The centre bounce clearances, Norwood. They're just dominating this factor in the last quarter. And their midfielders and small man running brigade, such as Harvey, James there with that goal, have just dominated. Full of run, the Redlegs.
70-point margin. 19-minute mark for last quarter. Cook, Jarman. He doesn't waste too many possessions when he gets them with that bit of that amount of space. And once again, Scotty Bassett has been moved up forward, takes a good mark. He's got player in the chef, the cook, whatever you want to call him, but he's taken it. Looks up. You've got it, fella. How is Gary McIntosh being
Paul McCormick there on the right of screen with the crutches. Anterior cruciate last week. That is a sad blow for him. And Ian Downsborough couldn't take his place in the side because of an ankle injury. You've got to just spare a thought for those three guys.
Yes, you do. Unfortunately, it's one of the parts of football, but a young bloke like this, gee, what a moment for him, Cook.
I'm going to cause him a bit of bother tonight, Mark.
Yes, our statistician Ian Mogridge, just give me a little, pass me a note. Norwood's biggest ever grand final win this will be. If the margin stays like this, it could even be extended.
Pascoe.
After we see Pascoe go forward.
He's got it. Pascoe gets his second. He's been pretty good today. Two goals, one. And they're celebrating in the terraces. Celebrations abound. Now give us that stat about the biggest margin.
Yeah, biggest ever grand final win this will be for the Norwood. But it will also be the Port's biggest ever defeat in a grand final.
You just see there on replay, Obst the smother. It's the reason for that goal. The 1%ers, Norwood have been so good at that today. The relentless pressure on their opposition, just running hard at the man, hard at the ball.
76 points, and there's one fan that's been waiting a long time for it. Fegan out of the middle, he's been probably Port Adelaide's best or one of their best. Bowman, who's been outstanding at centre back. This game will live in the memory, and I think there'll be a few drinks shouted at the Oraroo pub tonight. And Todd Davey back on the interchange bench after being stitched up, and he'll join his mates and celebrate, but I think he might have a headache before the celebrations start, this young fellow. And he came down from the Swans, came to Woodville West Torrens and recruited to the Redlegs, but I think he might have an AFL career ahead of him just yet. As Jarman toe pokes one towards Cunningham on the line, Borlase got it from Rowan Smith. Steadies and deliver. Underneath that one, Brett James thumps it down. Treadray, where's he been? He was just terrific in the first and second quarters. Dan Tokia forward. This is Roger. Roger the Dodger James, and boom. It's through. Roger gets his second. Well, it's raining goals for the Redlegs, and there's going to be a big celebration in the old town tonight. Hope you're enjoying this around Australia on ABC Sport.
And again, there's a situation at halfback where Norwood were able to win the 50-50 contest. The ball in, throw in, they were able to take it away. Port Adelaide, that has been their strength, but Norwood have really fought back well here today. And just through sheer run and persistence, finishing excellent finishing there as seen by James. Just been a tremendous turnaround.
82 point margin, 22 minute mark. The crowd's on its feet. Coach Peter Rhodes coming down to share the last final moments with his players on the bench and also his support staff. Really has been sensational season for Peter Rohde. We see Tregenza going forward, and that's Magpies' luck today. They've hit the post.
That was McGuinness.
But Peter Rohde, only his second year as coach. They're already celebrating on the bench. They're hugging each other, patting each other on the back. They realise that the margin is enough to get them home. Eastdoor thrown over the top by Trent Ray. Again, the ball's put forward. Smith's there, comes to ground. Burgoyne really hasn't been excited all day. Couldn't quite get his boot to the ball. He's only had the 12 possessions. But after two sensational finals that we saw early from Burgoyne, really has been well held this afternoon.
It's a lot to ask any youngster to play three terrific finals in a row. It's also a lot to ask any player that's over the age of 30 to do likewise. Port Adelaide have been, well, unfortunate in both aspects, missing today.
The Norwood Club, they've beaten in the reserves this afternoon by 1 point by the Magpies. They've come out here, the league side really has dominated all afternoon, haven't allowed the Magpies to get it. You can hear the chants gone up around the ground. They realise they've won this game. The ball goes up the northeast. Northeast on the outer wing comes inboard, finds Tregenza. He's taken the mark. He hasn't. He's been spoiled. There was Ashley.
Peter Rohde very happy. Councillor Pratt to his left. And it's been a long time coming, hasn't it? 1984. They're rewriting the history books. Andrew Jarman, you suspect, has exercised some demons from last year's final series where he played so poorly. This year, he set himself beautifully, and there he is diving on top of the ball. He jointly won the 1997 McGarry medal. Had a wonderful year, averaging over 30 possessions a game, and today he crowns it all with a premiership medallion. I'm sure he'll enjoy it. He'll be leading the charge tonight. A great character, Bolton. Out of the ruck contest, swings one forward, but it's Bowman who has been a rock of Gibraltar at centre-half back. Cunningham, who really has knocked up getting kicks and has stamped himself as a quality player. 24 for him this afternoon, this young fellow. And a starring role for the Redlegs. Pascoe thumps it down. Harvey pushes it forward. Over the top of it, Tyson works hard. The Foss Williams medalist from this year's state game against the ACT. Feeds it off and gets it back. Hasn't he had a season to remember? And Jimmy West couldn't quite take that one in. It would have been a fitting finish to the grand final for him to take that one and kick a goal. But it's Obst again pushing it forward and out of play. Ken, it's been a remarkable effort. You look through the Norwood side, they've got good players on every line.
They certainly have. Probably none better than Cunningham as a rover. Been just sensational form. Fleming at fullback has also been enormous. Harvey, the acting captain for the day, has had a big influence on the game.
Now, the Jack Odie medal, Ken, who you're speculating might be the best player in the grand final?
Oh, John Cunningham, I think, for the Norwood side. Tim Ginevar, clearly the best for Port Adelaide.
Thanks for that, Ken. We will see shortly whether you're right. As the ball comes in, Darren Smith takes charge and takes the mark right in the goal square. Fleming not happy, but Smith will go back to kick his second. Years of age, the big fella, has played in six premiership sides for Port Adelaide, but not one today, and that is his second.
Just going through those best players, David, like Harvey, Brett James, James Tyson, Obst, Jarman has been very good in the centre. You know, Cook, they've all been tremendous in the midfield for Norwood. Their key forward in West is produced. Pascoe's produced since coming on at centre-half forward. Bowman at centre-half back. Fleming at fullback. Their half-back line has been tremendous with Dan Tocchio, Clements both kicking goals and Pitt just chopping off everything. Like, they really have had winners all over the ground.
126 plays 52. They go out of the game. Neither player is stopping. Ball's kicked up. McGuinness puts it up. Fleming again. Ball goes through Fleming. First time for the afternoon. Pitt across to Bowman. Bowman can share it here to Cunningham. He's running at full pace still. Bowman goes up and finds Tyson. So Tyson. Cunningham still running. Tremendous work. Tyson got 26 possessions this afternoon. He's also had a good game over the back. Pascoe. The front of the pack again is the smaller midfield men of the Red Legs. Just there to snare at a game. But good work.
Not only has Tyson had those 26 possessions, Mark, clearly I can remember when the heat was really in the game in the second quarter there, Tyson it was that laid a tackle and a smother, both in midfield, that resulted in red leg goals.
At the bounce, it's Pascoe, grabbing the ball forward. Rowe Smith playing a defensive role on Rowe now, forces the ball out wide, out of bounds on the full. It's Peter Dream. Peter Rohde can sit and relax, and very rarely can you do that in a grand final. He's enjoying the moment. They were snuffed out of last year's finals race by Port Adelaide's Scott Hodges, who kicked a miraculous goal seconds before the siren. And Port Adelaide, history tells us, went on to win the grand final last year. The Redlegs thought it was theirs. But this year, well, spare a thought for Todd Davey. Lots of stitches in that right eye. Looks a little like Frankenstein. But I'm sure you win them and wear them. And winners are grinners, and he'll be grinning tonight. Rowan Smith, Troy Bond, Jared Poulton, and Short to Northeast, who really has had a lion-hearted effort today as he pushes it to Darren Smith. Well, why couldn't they do this, fans would ask, in the second and third quarters? But you just suspect that the Red Legs have taken the foot off the accelerator.
Yes, it's the tempo, the intensity of the pursuit by Norwood. It certainly has dropped off.
Two goals so far in this final quarter to Darren Smith, and he's hit the post there.
Talking of Port Adelaide, though, certainly North East has had a fine game. I've been impressed with Poulton. Started on a half-back flank. Had a couple of fundamental errors earlier, but then did settle. That's to be expected from a young player. And was put on the wing, centre wing, and really has, I think, played a reasonable game. And Tim Ginevar, I think, clearly their best, along with Fiegert.
It's all over. Port Adelaide have lost, and Norwood are the winners. 73 points, the final margin. And Norwood, 19-12, 126, have defeated Port 7 goals, 11, 53, as we go down to Peter Rohde.
Thanks for that, DP. Peter, well, it's been a long time coming, but I'm sure it feels sensational.
It does. You know, it's been a very long day. That last quarter's gone about 2.5 hours by me, I reckon. But the boys have been magnificent, you know, right from the start. They were switched on when they got here today, and I was really confident going into the game, more confident than maybe I should have been. But certainly they showed up when they got out there, they could do it.
Well, after that second semi-final, there was a bit of a question mark. What Adelaide team to lift? And after Gary McIntosh incident earlier this week, obviously the boys just dug deep and pulled out a sensational performance.
Yeah, maybe we needed those two hard games, the second semi and the preliminary, and certainly we're at our very best today, which is, you know, you work very hard all year, we play some good footy during the year, and you'd be disappointed if you couldn't play your best footy at the end. Which
I tell you what, there wasn't too many passengers today, they all put in.
No, I reckon we certainly haven't had a bad player. I think everyone's had a go. The blokes on the bench are pretty sore now, but they've done a wonderful job.
How long do you think Stephen Rowe's going to talk about that, Mark?
Oh, I think for a while. I think he's going to officially retire about now, so he'll live on that forever.
Good on you, Rohde. Thanks for that. Well done. Coach of the successful Norwood side call and the premiership side for 1997, Peter Rohde, DB. Sensational effort.
Thanks for that, Rob. Great scenes here at Football Park. We hope you've enjoyed the game. It's been a ripper. We've enjoyed bringing it to you. Ken Shelton, the coach, has just said Stephen Rowe looks like he'll retire. Let's hope he can go for one more year.
Well, let's hope so. But what a celebration. What a way to go out. Some great performers here today on the Red League team.
All right, we asked you before your best players, but let's run through them.
I think in the midfield, Cunningham was probably the best player on the ground. I think Anthony Harvey, acting captain, was also magnificent. And Dale Fleming played a magnificent game at fullback. Whilst for Port Adelaide, I think Tim Ginevar, the best on the ground for them, Nigel Fiegert and Paul Northeast.
Port Adelaide dejected. They've won the last three in a row. They've won 34 premierships since the start of the club. And this will hurt them. They are a proud club, and they've only once in the last 12 attempts lost. And this is their biggest losing margin ever.
We talked though before about how you rebound, like in football, the opportunity, like you're always getting kicked in the belly in footy, and it's how you rebound. And Norwood finished third last year, were beaten in the second semi and win today.
As we go down to Rob Popplestone for the announcement of the Jack Otey Medal winner.
DB, I can tell you just in finishing that the Jack Otey medalist for 1997 will be John Cunningham.
John Cunningham, fair choice. Ken, you happy with that?
I am. I think, look, particularly when you consider that boy's season. He won Norwood's Best and Fairest last year, had a knee injury in the first opening minutes of this season, rebounded, was clearly unfit in the second semi, but through sheer courage, determination and persistence has worked his way back into, well, the ultimate.
We should restate that the Redlegs were certainly the best attacking side and the best defensive side throughout the year. In their 20 matches, they won 17 and lost 3, so clearly they were the superior side throughout the season.
Their win today was set up by their defence. Fleming, Dantokia, Clements, Bowman, magnificent centre-half pack. Pitt and Davies, they rebounded everything, as did Port Adelaide's defence also. But then the Norwood midfield got on top. Jarman, Tyson, Obst, Harvey, Cook, and particularly Cunningham. Also, the two James boys were very impressive.
So some new legends being created at the parade. The Redlegs, winners of the 1997 SANFL Grand Final. It's now down to Rob Popplestone
to present the Jack Otey medalist for 1997. And the winner of the Jack Otey medal for 1997 is Norwood's John Cunningham.
Just a couple of years ago, he won the Norwood side's best and fairest last year. This year, he had a knee reconstruction in March. They thought he wouldn't play until next year, but two games before the end of the season, he declared himself for these finals. They played him twice in the reserves. He was best each time. He kicked 2-2 and in the two in the second semi-final, two in the preliminary final, and today he kicked two as well. Not a bad effort. Now there, Ken, is the Thomas Seymour Hill Trophy. That's what Norwood collect tonight, and I dare say there'll be a few little wet drinks from that.
Well, to get your hands and your lips on that is truly one of the real joys of football, to win the Premiership Cup. Congratulations to the Redlegs, they were fantastic. Andrew Jarman there in screen, 15 kicks and 13 handballs in the centre of the ground. Had a great duel with Paul Ace, the Port Adelaide Deputy Vice Captain.
Big Jim West, number 9 there, the Ken Farmer medalist. Recruited from Glenelg this year, plays in a premiership team. As we go back to Rob Popplestone.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'll introduce to you Mr. Lynn Fitzgerald, All-Australian inductee, winner of the McGarry Medal on 3 occasions, to present the premiership medals to the Norwood Football Club. So I first ask Stephen Rowe. Mark his way onto the dais. Dale Fleming. Damien Obst. After taking a heavy knock early in the game, number 7, Todd Davey. Leading goal kicker in the SANFL for season 97, number 9, James West. Number 10, Adelaide wouldn't be the same without him, Andrew Jarman. Number 11, Brett James. Number 16, and Jack Only medalist, John Cunningham. Number 18, Aaron Keating. Number 16, and Jack Only medalist, John Cunningham. Number 18, Aaron Keating. Number 20, Roger James. Number 24, Andrew Pascoe. Number 25, Troy Clements. Number 26, Stephen Pitt. Number 27, Simon Easter. Head before the start of the game, and it's even rougher now after a few knocks. Number 28, Glenn Malloy. Number 29, Lachlan Bowman. Number 31, Scott Bassett. Number 36, Jerry D'Antocchia. Number 44, Sujai Cook. Number 47, James Tyson. Captain for the 1997 Grand Final was Anthony Harvey. I think it'd be remiss of me not to mention the man who couldn't play today, Gary McIntosh. Thank you.
Pass to the coach, Peter Rohde. Premiership Cup.
So the final score here in favour of the Red Legs. They've run out victors this afternoon in the 1997 SANFL Grand Final. 1912-126 to a 7-11-53. On behalf of Ken Sheldon, Mark Naley, Rob Popplestone and all our crew, thanks for your company right around Australia. We hope you've enjoyed it and we hope to see you back here next year.